You're listening to the Bad Boys of the Paranormal, Dead X Radio.
Hey everyone, welcome to the show.
Hey, we are live.
This is a big episode for us, actually. This is the show that your mama warned you about, I think, is...
Yeah, that's today's tag. Sure.
We are the show that after you get done listening, you do need a penicillin shot.
Yes, you should actually go see your doctors before you watch today. We have actually a huge show lined up today. We have Mr. Michael Pare.
Yes.
Nice.
From awesome. Eddie and the Cruisers. He was also in the Philadelphia Experiment, which is kind of a little bit of a paranormal type
Which goes movie. Right down
goes
our alley.
Goes right down
here.
Exactly yeah, what absolutely. We have going on. Yeah. And he was in...
The Infiltrator, Lincoln Lawyer. Pretty much you almost yeah, named the movie he's been in.
Yeah, he's got a pretty extensive...
Hope Floats.
Yeah, which, yeah, X's favorite, you know, movie yeah. is.
Of course it is.
Hope Floats, because, you know, he loves him.
I have a black and white TV with antennas with the...
Bunny ears.
That's how old I am, yeah.
Yeah, well, we all know how old you are.
Yeah.
We called you Methuselah before.
Yes.
So, he'll be calling in here in a little bit, and then we have a surprise guest that we just found out about last minute that we're really super excited about.
Confirmed.
Yes,
confirmed.
We have Mr. Thom Matthews from Return of the Living Dead and Return of the Living Dead 2. Friday 13th, Part 6, Jason Lives.
Wow.
He's also on, oh my God, like Blood Match. I mean, he's also another guy who's been in a ton of films.
Awesome.
And the great thing is about these two guests we have coming on today, they have came and spawned from iconic films that we remember in like our history growing up and everything.
That's it. We yes. we grew yeah. up on these guys' movies. I mean, because we're all old, so Eddie and the Cruisers you know, was a huge movie for me, and then the Return of the Living Dead movies were just iconic, like you said.
Well, I thought iconic because they're calling it a Dead X Radio is pretty iconic, if you ask me.
Well,
no one asked you.
Yeah.
That is a good point. No one did ask.
And when you do get asked, this is what happens to you.
Oh.
I
thought this was Tyndall. This is
oh,
our
no,
intern.
That's where the yeah. last intern ended up because he asked questions.
Yeah, well, they're referring
it's a good
to the
thing
headless,
I'm a host.
The headless person. You can see it in the camera now if you if you're watching at home. The headless person on the desk that is our last intern.
Yeah, and this headless person we had found at John Rusnak's studio, Frightmare Productions studio. We are currently actually doing the show live at the studio right now.
That's yes,
right.
we are, and actually, this studio has big meaning for Chance. Maybe this is. Where we met, well, not at this location, but at a movie that both of us were acting in for this studio, Frightmare Studios, called House of Blood. Both of us, Chance and I, act in that movie, and we will show you the trailer for that movie later on in the show. But so this is kind of a little sentimental moment for Chance and I.
Yeah, absolutely. Aww. And also, too, this show in particular has gone full circle because John Rusnak also was on the film Infiltrator, with Michael Pare and John Leguizamo.
How coincidental is that?
Yes.
Okay, I was just about to say, there's a word that Patrick loved to say that we all get sucked into, and we're going to say it on the count of three. One, two, three.
Synchronicity.
See, I thought you two told me you went on a gay porn.
That was a fantasy you had.
Oh, is that a fantasy?
Yes.
Okay.
That was it. Yeah.
But
yeah,
I just want to make sure.
Yeah. But the thing is, like we said, I mean, you know, we're also doing our show live now. We're going to be doing the show live from different, you know, areas and all over the place. But John, being one of our good friends, was a, you know, gracious host of letting us come down here and, you know, and do this show at his production studio. And it's awesome. And he's done a lot of films as well. I mean, everything from, you know, from directing to writing, producing, you know, doing props for the film. Like with Infiltrator, he's the one who did all the guns and the props for the film.
We took a walk through his studio earlier, and he has some of the most amazing props. I mean, you see this head we have on the table here.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and we're going to post those pictures up later on the website and everything for you guys to check it out.
Yeah absolutely. You'll be able to check out our websites, our Facebooks, our Twitter, you know,
it'll
Twitters,
be all over. Yeah.
Everything. We have it all over the place right now. We're
got
having
a big
so much
cast.
Fun. Oh, yeah, we actually have a Bigfoot cast. Can we show that on camera real quick?
Can we show that?
Yeah, use the camera there.
Right, here we go.
All right, there.
We have a cast of the Bigfoot right here that's actually, John was talking about doing a film, which I will not say too much of.
Don't
but
break it.
We'll say that the cast is a part of it.
So, is that an actual Bigfoot cast, or is that just.
Yeah, I took this early this morning. I just wanted to watch it.
He got that in his front yard.
Out in holiday.
Yeah, I believe that. In holiday, yeah. It's the holiday.
It's a good thing my feet are hidden under the table.
I'm going to say the awesome thing is it was actually made from Patrick's cast of his foot. However, he's only 5'1".
Hey, you know, it is what it is, I guess.
It is what it is.
So today's show, the main theme is supposed to be aliens and UFOs,
right?
Which makes sense that we have Michael Pare and Matthew, or yeah. Tom Matthews.
Yeah, of course, right hand in hand. It sounds like it.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, actually, you know, we had discussed this, me and Chance, earlier today, that we were actually going to discuss a little bit of time travel, because a theory out there is that UFOs are actually like time travelers from distant future.
Yeah.
So it would actually go right along that lines, because in the Philadelphia experiment, there was a little bit of time travel that occurred in that movie.
Way to bring it around, Sean.
Yeah,
hey,
absolutely.
That's what I'm here for.
I could have used a little bit of time traveling today because there was way too much to do to get ready for the show.
Yeah, usually, I mean, we do our production stuff like a day in advance, or things ready to roll by the next day. But this is the first time we actually are out on the road doing the show now, because with all new gear that we got.
Yep.
And, well, we had to play it by ear on certain things, get everything rolling. And dude, we're the A-team of the Paranormal.
Oh, yeah.
We can pull off anything.
It's funny.
Mean, it's always last minute crunch. It's always last minute crunch. It really is.
Well, no, the funny thing is, whenever everyone's like, okay, how long until we're live? And we look and go, 2 minutes.
Like, oh, shit.
And the funny thing is, you have no idea how fast 2 minutes can go.
Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely. You can ask some of Tyndall's dates.
But don't bump.
That I'm guessing is probably the longest 2 minutes of their life.
And you know what? That's one of the worst things about doing live shows like we do. There is no coming back.
No.
Once it's out there, it's out there. I mean, you know, that's the reason why we all agreed that we were going to have to do, you know, podcasts, that our show was going to be on the internet, because we didn't want to be reined by FCC fines, because we are uncensored. We're live, you know, raw.
Whoa. Do you mean that we can say words like fart?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
fart,
yeah. No, because that's like a bad word.
I mean, come on. We're one of the first shows out there that got Alexander Holster to say fuck on
Yeah,
air,
we did so. Get Alexander Holster to say fuck.
Yes.
And so, I wonder what we're going to be able to get Michael Pare to say.
Well, I know when I spoke to him on the phone earlier, he did drop the F-bomb.
Oh, the F-bomb. Yeah.
Anyone that talks to you drops the F-bomb.
Absolutely. I can coax it out of anybody, you know. And usually I notice in most of my texts from my friends that usually the end of our conversation ends with me being texted dick. So,
good.
Yeah.
Good. So today's
show.
You
are show, what you eat.
Today's show, actually, you know, since we are talking about aliens, our segment coming up later, which is legit or bullshit, is going to be an alien-based story that we're going to chime in on, and you all can call in and give us your opinion on the story. And, you know, we'll talk about that when the time comes. And then we have our X list. Which what's the theme of our X list today, Chance?
The X list we are doing today is the top 10 reasons you think you may have been abducted by aliens.
Top 10 reasons you may think that you've been abducted by aliens. So
that's
interesting. I like the concept of that. So you know, we'll have some fun with that. And now,
and you know, there will be anal probing involved.
Oh, of course.
And that's just from Patrick.
I know. You know, the worst part is we actually say that in our commercial for our show.
I think we do.
You
know what I mean?
Well, yeah, we do. I'm the pitcher. You guys are the catcher, just so you know.
I don't play baseball. Because I don't pitch or catch anything.
And this is why we are on the internet once again.
All right, so let's look at that severed head one more time. So this was the FCC that tried to contain us.
Right, yes.
Yes.
So we cut his head off. So, okay, so aliens are going to be like the main topic. I know that a lot of the theories, like you were speaking of earlier, where the time travel is kind of involved in the aliens, because of the, you know, the whole wormholes, you know, the folding of the atmosphere to where you can just kind of like go between,
yep,
you know, and real fast.
Yeah, and instead of going from A to B, you bring A and B together.
Yes, yes.
Time bending kind of concept.
Exactly.
And that's where we get into portals. And, you know, there's a lot of different groups out there that love to talk about portals.
Yes. And black holes.
Why do I feel this is about to go pornographic?
Yeah.
We were just brought an alien baby in a jar.
There we go.
Patrick,
we go.
Pull that up to
hold
the camera.
That up to
I
the
can
camera.
Hold that up to the camera. Look,
wrong camera.
Yeah, bring it up to the
wrong camera.
This camera.
Hello. It usually helps if you take it from the other side of your mic, because camera can't
no one
see
can see around the mic.
Ta-da.
Ta-da.
Dude. And this is why Patrick is not Vanna White.
He's like that dog you can't get to come across the yard. You're just all day long going, come here, boy. Come here, boy. Come here.
Hey, he just blankly stares at you.
Hey, wait. Before we do go on to the alien topic real quick, I think we should do our shout-outs. So I got a couple here that I really need to talk about real quick. Oh, you know,
and we didn't introduce anybody today either.
That's true.
Yeah.
I mean, by now, if you guys don't know us, then fuck you.
Let's do it one more time.
I agree. True big totally. League, or was it?
Well, I want to go first.
You want to go first? Okay, we'll let Patrick go first.
As we all know, I'm Patrick X. My first shout out is to my lovely love of my life, my wife, Joanna Macedonio, whose birthday is this weekend.
Oh, happy birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Jesus.
Here it goes.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Joanna. Happy birthday to you.
And all of a sudden, FedEx Radio got canceled.
Now, the funny thing is, you know, Joanna is younger than me, quite. And I was told,
she's 12.
I am a pimp. Thank you.
He's like, I'm the man.
I am the man. Okay, so anyway,
she also was blind, by the way.
Yes, exactly, and deaf and mute.
Perfect.
But, the funny part about it is, she told me today if I mentioned her age, there'd be some paranormal shit going on at my house. So
let's just leave it right there.
I just have really one more shout out. First of all, I want to thank James from the Mile High Club. I got a good job. I'm the new manager there at Almerton Road in Clearwater. So I hope you come out and see us.
Yes, one day Patrick will be full-time like the rest of us because he kind of sucks at it.
Yes, but got to. All right, so that's my shout-outs, and to all my children, I love you, all of them.
Even the ones he doesn't know of.
Yes, there's probably quite a few.
All right, Chance, it's your turn.
All right, I give a shout-out to my munchkins. We have Cheyenne, Lily, and also over to Miles. And then my stepson, Noah, who graduated from a college class.
Oh, like, awesome.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's not like college, don't get me wrong here. He's like, you know, in his early teens, and this is like an advanced course he's taking.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, and also, congrats. Too, I don't like to give out too much information about the kids for their safety and stuff, but Noah, you know, he graduated from it, and I'm so proud of him. Also, shout out to Liz, you know, for giving birth to our child, Lily. And then also, I'd like to give a shout out to Stephanie for doing our voiceover now for Devin's
Radio. Yes, thanks, Stephanie.
Thank you.
Awesome. And then over here to my right, we have Tyndall, who's lost in thought and taking notes. So if you want to borrow the mic here, you can say hi.
What's up?
Jesus.
And hence why he doesn't have one.
All right, so moving down the line.
Moving on down the line to me, I don't really have anybody to shout out to, except for everyone who has actually supported us and told us, hey, good job, keep it up. You guys are rocking. Hey, we're behind you. So big shout out to you guys. Shout out to my mom and dad again, because like I said, I don't have a significant other. Hey, ladies. other than that, like I said, big shout out to everyone who's telling us to keep kicking ass and rocking forward and moving forward and doing what we do. So
definitely our
big
fans.
Shout out to you guys.
Yeah. Yes, shout out to the fans.
And John Rusnak for letting us do our show.
Yes, absolutely.
My name is Jeff Hillier. You can hit me up on Twitter at Jeff Hillier, JeffHillyer.
Please help him. He needs followers.
I do. Please. I have no one following me. And when I tweet stuff, like, I just hear chirps. So thank you to John Rusnak. He's lent us his studio and brought us back together. And he's shown us so much love since we've been here. He's an amazing guy. And I'm excited that today's show is going to be so good.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
To throw it out there, we are in talks with John about a paranormal film.
Yes, we are.
And that's as much as we're going to say about it. But yes, you can also follow me, Chance, at my Twitter, at ChanceDXR. Pretty simple. And I'm on Facebook at Chance Hancock. Pretty simple.
Go ahead, Pat. Give out your Twitter, because I know you're dying to. I can see it through this head over here.
It's Pat Webb, DXR. @PatWebDXR. Yeah, I'm the big Twitter person here.
Is it really?
You can find me on Facebook, Patrick Webb, Patrick X, Dead X Radio, all things paranormal.
I've got a phone call coming in. You are on air with Dead X Radio.
Hey, it's Michael Pare here. How you doing, guys?
Michael Pare, how are you doing, sir?
I'm okay. I'm in Los Angeles.
Nice. How's the weather?
How's the weather rolling in L.A. right now?
It's probably hot in Florida.
What's up?
How's the weather out there right now?
It's about 77 degrees in Hollywood.
Oh, nice.
Which is where I am.
Yeah, 98 here in Florida.
Yeah, we're dying here. So,
98 is humid, right?
Yes.
Humid. Very. You've been here.
I was
here.
Just in Tampa not so long ago.
Tampa? Okay.
Yeah, you were filming The Infiltrator here, weren't you?
Exactly. I loved it. It's going to be a fantastic movie.
Yeah,
I played
you know
a great
what?
Role. I played,
go ahead. No, tell us about your role in the movie.
I played Barry Shields. You know who that is?
Barry Shields.
He's a famous drug smuggler, and he worked with the CIA and and laundering money. Dennis Hopper did the movie.
Nice.
And it's funny, I worked with Dennis right after he did that movie, and he told me all about him. So I had like a easy preparation.
So and that is awesome because that's one of the big conspiracy theories out there right now about the with the CIA, one of the conspiracy theories about them being involved with their own drug smuggling and such. And this is one of the living proofs right here that yes, they were involved.
Yes, exactly. So did you learn anything about the historical aspect of it that you didn't already know while filming?
No. No, except that he gets assassinated.
And we'll be investigating that later.
But you don't know who kills him, whether it's the drug dealers or the CIA.
Oh, right on.
Uh-huh. Yeah, my money's on the CIA.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, what do you think? Do you think it was the CIA or the drug dealers?
They're all the same. That's all it is.
So one just gets paid by actual payroll.
Once you're not regulated by common law, then you're all gangsters.
Exactly.
No, yeah. Actually, absolutely.
Yep. That is the truth. It really is. So you worked on the Philadelphia Experiment.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and the funny thing about that movie is I read the book when I was a freshman in high school. My brother was an engineer. Well, he was studying engineering, and he came home from school once, and he left that book. So I kind of knew all about it, and it's fascinating because, the people involved were all the top scientists in the world. This wasn't like some, kids in the backyard. Einstein, Opperman, and you know who else was? L. Ron Hubbard. L. Ron Hubbard was really? Part of Navy Intelligence.
I didn't know that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, did you know that?
No,
I didn't know that.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, it's an amazing thing, because they were experimenting with the same stuff that Tesla was, playing around with, trying to create an electromagnetic field that's similar to gravity, which is one of the primal forces in the universe, and opening a door to another dimension suddenly isn't so much science fiction as they know it's possible, and they just can't do it consistently. So, imagine the technological leap from World War II to today, right?
Yeah.
No kidding. Now I have to say right now, automatically at this moment, I'm jealous because Michael Pare is an actor, smart, obviously, big muscle guy. I'm done. I'm jealous, man.
Yeah.
Calm down, Chance.
we're doing our show from a studio. John Rusnak actually was one of the guys on set with you for The Infiltrator, and he has a picture of you guys flexing muscles together, and John's a big boy, and your muscle, your arm pretty much overpowers him by like fivefold.
What did he do in the movie? Who did he play?
John was the guy who did all the guns and props.
The gun stuff, yeah.
He was the prop
guy. Oh, that guy. Oh, okay. Right, okay.
Yeah, that guy.
We're actually doing our show live at his studio today at Frightmare Productions.
Yes.
Yeah, so when he showed it, yeah, but from what like Chance was just saying, yeah, you're intelligent, you're an actor, you're a good-looking guy. I mean, please, I'm straight, but I mean, you are a very attractive man. And so
I just think you're cool. I just want to let that.
Okay, but I have a serious question for you. What is your favorite movie that you've worked on?
My first one, Eddie and the Cruisers, yes! is the one that kind of got me recognized and gave me my career, really.
Yes.
It was before it was a business, it was all about magic at that time, so I'll always remember it as, when I really became, for the greatest American hero. I had a small role.
I was just going to say
you know?
Yep, we're showing our age for sure.
Yeah, because I was actually watching.
Yeah, I had one or two lines per episode, but in Eddie and the Cruises, you know,
yep.
I was supposed to be a supporting role.
Yep.
And I broke out as the lead, so it was like, yes. You know,
really?
This is, it established me as, as a leading guy.
Yeah, absolutely. I was a big fan of the show, The Greatest American Hero, and I remember seeing you on there. And I brought that up to some of my friends. I'm like, you know, do you remember the TV show Greatest American Hero? And they were like, yeah, I remember that, you know, with William Catt. And I
William
said, well,
Catt, yep.
Michael Pare was on that show as well, you know? So, I mean, you really are. You're kind of like an iconic figure in film history and, like, you know, with also... You know, like Eddie and the Cruisers, you know, the Philadelphia Experiment, you know, the Greatest American Hero. You are that person who's like really made a stamp in Hollywood, you know?
Yes. And you make us all feel old today talking about these particular movies.
and everyone that I've talked to has a different favorite movie that comes to mind when your name is mentioned. I happened to mention to my brother earlier this week that you were coming on the show, and he says, oh, Commandant from Blubberella.
Blubberella. Oh man, that was so much fun to do. Yeah. People think Uwe Boll is just fucking insane, but he's actually a brilliant guy, and he'll let you do stuff that other people won't. You know,
great.
Yeah, I put on this fat suit, you know, and I'm playing a Nazi, and I'm doing a Marlon Brando impression. I mean, and Uwe was saying, "Yeah, this is good. Do it more, Marlon Brando." I love Uwe.
That's great. Yeah,
but he is a madman.
Well, it looks like you had a lot of fun with it, at least.
Yeah.
Hey, can you let us in on like what's your next up and coming project you're working on now?
Well, I've got like four in the can. I got two that are coming out this coming year. One is called Abattoir, and the other is Infiltrator.
Mm-hmm.
But I just did a couple of action movies with this young director named Tim Woodward. And one of them looks really cool because I've seen some footage of it. It's called Forgotten, 4GOT10, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a small story with a bunch of really cool characters. And, I play a corrupt sheriff, and I have a cowboy hat, you know, and I spit tobacco, you know, and I carry a shotgun. It's just a very artsy action movie, and I'm really excited about it. But, I got a few more things coming up this year, and I don't want to put the jinx on them by mentioning them before, you know, we start shooting.
Okay.
Well, I was going to say with that.
Things are looking good. Like I said, Abattoir is already, they've already ordered the sequel. So, you know, it's going to be a good project.
Awesome.
The guy who directed Saw 3 and 4, Darren Bozeman, was the writer director.
Awesome.
That's
great. And we got along really well. And I was doing my ADR, you know, the automatic dialogue replacement.
Yep.
Like 2 weeks ago. And he says, it's announced in the trades that we've been greenlit for the sequel. And I said, fuck, man, that's great.
Wow.
Am I in it? And he said, yeah, you have a great part in it. So I'm very excited about that. I got along with him really well. He's a very bright, he's just, you can see this is a guy who's got an enormous future as a serious filmmaker.
Awesome. Nice. Now, see, we really like to get into, like, the personal lives of, like, the people we have come on our show. So I'm just curious, when you find out that you're getting that role that you wanted, do you, like, play it nice and cool in front of everybody, like, oh, great, awesome, I got it? Or do you turn around and walk away and do, like, a little happy dance when nobody's looking?
I kind of explode, man. You know, when I get a great role, like when Brad Furman told me that he wanted me for Infiltrator, you know, I had to audition like 3 or 4 times on tape, you know, because you know he's the director, so he's very powerful. But now budgets are so big that there's a whole group of people that have to approve of you.
Yeah.
So Brad said he really wanted me, and I was like, oh, please, please, please. And then he says, you got it, dude, you killed it, you're in.
Nice.
Taking your lungs in it. And it was just like, fuck you! Yes! it was just, when you get the big ones, it's really fucking cool, man.
Yeah.
You know, it's really cool.
Well, for me, you know, this is Chance talking right now. For me and for Jeff Hillier, when we got to be in John Rusnak's film, House of Blood, we were like that. You know, he was like, yeah, I want to bring you guys on this film, you know, and do some small parts. You know, and I am not going to lie. I could not, like, sleep the first night when I found out. I was so wired and full of energy.
Yeah, that's the thing for me, too. Whenever I can get a really good part, you get excited about it. And I see, for me, I can't imagine that Michael Pare has to still audition.
Hey, man, I don't mind auditioning either. You know, I don't want to walk on a set and have everybody wonder if I can do it.
Oh, yeah,
absolutely. You know, I want them to be excited about me getting, you know, because it's both characters, the Abattoir and Infiltrator, were both, like, roles that you don't normally see them casting me in.
Yeah.
So, you know, when they want me to audition, I got to prove myself. And I'll tell you, man, I've been acting for 35 years. Mm. I'm not afraid of proving myself, you know.
Oh,
give me the material, and I'll deliver a performance. And I'm kind of proud of that. I'm not, you know... I don't think I really felt right being, you know, because they tried to make me into a superstar early on, and I just wasn't, you know, I was too fucking young to, you know, to pull that off. I was a kid.
Yeah.
You know, I was a kid, and I like being, you know, a working actor, and I have no qualms about, you know, proving that I deserve the part.
Yeah, and absolutely.
And, you know, but I tell you, it does mean a lot when the director... Or, you know, the producer says, you're my guy, but you're going to have to jump through some hoops, you know.
Yeah.
When you have, like, a heavyweight behind you, you know, you get your fucking balls up and you feel confident and, you know, it helps a lot. Well, that Furman, you know, he put me in Lincoln Lawyer.
Yep.
He wanted to put me in Rudder Rudder, but, you know, that was one where they wouldn't go with me.
Really?
But when he called for Infiltrator... And sent me the script. He says, "You know, this is not a role that they see you in. So you're gonna have to put it on tape and send." And I did do it like 3 or 4 times. But every time I sent it in, he gave me notes on what to keep and what to cut. You know.
Yeah.
And you know, when the director wants you, it's an enormous asset.
Yeah, because they're gonna fight for you.
So with that being said, what was like the hardest film that you really had to work hard to get onto then?
To get on?
Yeah.
Well, Lincoln Lawyer and an Infiltrator. Oh. The one with Sandra Bullock.
Hope Floats.
I had to audition 8 times for that.
Wow.
Well, one thing, yeah. I mean, your acting ability, I mean, just this is Jeff Hillier speaking. One thing that really stuck out to me, I mean, Eddie and the Cruisers was one of my favorite movies growing up, and just the lines in there about, you know, if we can't be great, then there's no point in doing it. I felt those lines when you said them, and it really has affected my life and pushed me to do the big things that I've done in my life. And just a testament to your acting, because I really believe you saying those lines in that movie, you felt that too yourself.
Yeah, well, you know, that was a great cast, you know, and it was a great fucking role.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was done like, you know, kind of like a play, because they put us in a dumpy hotel in the middle of New Jersey, and we had like two or three weeks to just rehearse and improv and do all that stuff that, you know, you do in workshops and, you know, when you're going to do theater.
Uh-huh.
So it was really a perfect situation.
Yeah.
Well, we were too far from New York to go to New York, so we all hung around together. We really created that bond of a band, you know, and, you know, there's a lot of trust and support from everybody for each other.
Yeah. Well, for us, like, you know, the primary objective behind our show is mostly paranormal. And, you know, we already discussed about you doing Philadelphia Experiment, but I also spoke with director John Fallon for a film you just did not long ago called The Shelter.
Oh, John Fallon! Oh, man! You see, John is a guy who is so passionate, and he's been a critic for so long. I mean, he sees everything. You know, I know he's been on, you know, a bunch of sets, but he sits and he studies movies from the screen, you know, like kind of like Quentin Tarantino.
Yeah.
He worked in a fucking video store. So he saw everything. So he saw the shots that work and what works and what doesn't work and what you need and what you don't need. I think John has an enormous future.
Well, he's coming on our show on the 27th, and I'm going to make sure I tell him you said hi.
Yeah.
Oh, he's coming on later on?
The 27th. July 27th, yeah. He'll be on.
Oh, cool, cool. Yeah, that movie I did with John, you see, here's John. John was the other way. He got some private financing. He hired me for, you know, he knew I was going to be great at this because he and Eric Red were great friends. And Eric Red and I did two movies together. And Eric also encouraged me to do some really cool stuff. I did the werewolf movie, Bad Moon, with him. Yeah, and then also the one with Pomke Janssen, 100 Feet. Right, so Eric and I, you know, were really close, and consequently, so was John. John came over for both of the movies, and you know, he knows what I could do, so it wasn't like convincing him. But John found this great camera guy that understood the vision that he needed. Right, And John and the DP, Holbrook, Bobby Holbrook. You know, you just saw them working, like, very synchronistic. I think, is that the term, synchronicity?
Synchronicity.
There wasn't any confusion. It's like, John and Bobby just, you know, they were both, you know, creating the same fucking idea. There was no, like, I want the camera here, and the other guy wants the camera there. Yeah. No, it should be a little higher. No, it should be a little lower. No, let's not waste time on a two-shot. No, you know, they just fucking... Like, they've known each other for 20 years.
They both got it, yeah.
Yeah. So this is Patrick, Mike. So you know Jeff personally then, apparently, right? Because that's how he would be with camera shots.
What are you talking about?
Yeah, Jeff. Hillier, you were explaining how the guys do that in the studio.
Yeah.
And Jeff's like, that's okay.
Jeff. Yeah, that's like our guy, Jeff. Jeff is the same way with cameras. Everything has to be perfect the way he wants it, his view. Yeah.
But he does a good job. He is.
Oh, well, thank you guys.
The best.
Okay, I don't know why they're sucking up to me with you on the phone. So I since we are a paranormal show, I do have a question for you about paranormal stuff. Have you ever personally experienced anything that you're like, holy shit?
You mean like aliens and that kind of stuff?
Yeah, anything like ghosts?
I've been open, I'm a true believer in all that stuff. I've been training and meditating for a long, long time. I used the Robert Monroe out of body tapes for a while, and I started to lift out twice, but the fear, snapped me back like a rubber band.
Wow. And,
but I did start to lift out. I did, I started to be sucked up in the vortex, and the fear just, broke the whole spell.
Yeah.
But that's about it, But, acting, there's been magical moments in my career. And, what can I say?
So no weird things happening on the sets of some of the creepy movies you've done?
No.
Well, that's good.
No, I wish, I watch Ancient Aliens all the time. All I watch, UFO files unopened, or opened, all that stuff. And I believe it's out there, but I'm just not witnessing it.
Yeah. Now we're kind of the same way. We're skeptical. One of our topics later on in the show is going to be about aliens and kind of about a lot of the different things that the rumors that are going on out there. And there's just we're kind of like you. We believe, but we're just not seeing a lot of it.
Right.
Yeah. It's like, how do they choose who gets to look? But like those UFOs over Phoenix, Arizona. That's pretty hard to deny, man.
Absolutely.
It was there for like 45 minutes. It's like, it's there.
Yeah.
It's there. And, it's just, they talked about it on CNN, for God's sake.
Yeah, it was there. And it was 45 minutes, and you had like hundreds of people seeing it.
More than that, actually.
Right. Yeah, everybody who could see him saw it.
Right.
But, for some reason, people don't keep talking about that.
Okay.
These were flares. It was this. It was that. And then the governor goes and makes a joke about it on television. He walks a guy out in a fucking alien suit. Mm-hmm. I don't understand why they do that. It just implies that there's a serious cover up for some reason.
Right.
And I was just going to ask you if you thought there was a cover up. So you just answered my question for me.
Well, there's just, even if only 1% of the theory is true, that means it's all true. Not all, every sighting is true, but if just 1% of the millions of sightings is true. You know, what about that Japanese guy, the Japanese pilot, you know, for Air Japan?
Oh, for Air Japan, you know, yes.
Right? He had, you know, over Alaska, the giant, you know, UFO, they have it for, you know, a half hour on the radar. You know, it's like, it's all there. Or those guys in London, you know, who touched the spaceship and then he spouted out all of those, the binary language.
Yeah, binary codes.
You know, it's like, come on, guys, you know, who are we kidding? Why are we denying? You know, don't tell me, oh, it'll upset the Catholics. You know, it's like, it's bullshit. even the Pope has said that there's life out there.
That's yeah. Thank you.
He did. I think he
did. Yeah. So, come on. You know, why are we not, you know, the best theory is that it would fuck up the oil and military industrial complex.
Well, I know that, but they spent so much time covering it up.
The four major banks, the four major oil companies, and the military industrial complex would be destroyed if all of this alien technology became available, because it's all about energy. You know?
Absolutely.
Yes. You know what? We're going to have Michael Parade just come on our show from now on and help us with our theories and stuff.
Yeah.
He seems to know as much as we do about
exactly.
it. So.
No, you're 100%
well,
right.
You know, I once I got you know, all those free channels, you know, I get to watch all of this stuff, you know.
You're right. There's a lot of just conspiracy and cover-ups out there. I mean, personally, I wouldn't mind our alien overlords coming down and kind of kicking the government's ass a little bit and,
yes,
and shaking things up.
Well, you know, remember, even Reagan said that he had a UFO experience on the Pacific Coast Highway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, Jimmy Carter.
You know, and he made that speech at the UN. Just imagine that if there was an alien threat, how that would unite the planet. I mean, all this stuff, there's all these hints, you know, and Bill Clinton saying there is life in outer space because they find that microbe in the moon rock or the Mars rock or something.
Yep,
you know,
absolutely.
It's like, everybody knows it's true, but for some reason we're not getting it. Just like all of that alternative energy. You know, in Sweden, they have the hydrogen highway, right? For all the hydrogen cars.
Yeah.
You can get a hydrogen producer the size of a refrigerator that would power your house and your car. And we would be, every family would be energy independent.
Right. Well, like you said, you know, it would hit into those oil companies and it would hit all those big name guys that were making billions upon trillions of dollars every year.
Yeah, won't be approved in the
USA. Yeah, of maintaining conflict in the world, you know?
Right.
Yeah, and absolutely. And the government has spent so much time
denying it. Am I into conspiracy? No, I think, I think it is a conspiracy to keep the world in conflict. Mm. And then they say, oh, yeah, but conflict creates growth, and growth is evolution, and you know, all this other crap. And it's like, you know.
Good word.
We have global unity now through the internet. You know, who was that guy who was giving away the free hand cranks computers, you know, to Africa and India?
Oh.
They're like $10, and you can have access to the internet. Mm-hmm. Free access to the internet. How are they going to stop the next generation from saying, wait a minute, all right, the oil companies won't let Americans have their hydrogen cars? Well, Sweden has them already. Mm-hmm. They have the hydrogen highway. It's already online. But for some reason, we're not getting it in the United States. Let's see what happens with Tesla. If Tesla would bring down the price of those cars, you know, why not? Why not? You know, Canada has the biggest deposit of lithium in the world.
Right.
Which is the main component of these super batteries. You know, it used to be in Afghanistan.
Yep.
You know, and I figured, all right, so we're in Afghanistan for the heroin and for the lithium.
All right.
Yeah, well,
now we have the lithium in Canada, and we get the heroin from South America and Mexico. So, you know, we don't have to be over there anymore.
It's diversifying. Yeah, so and like you said, I mean, you bring up the Tesla car. That's something that I think that technology, once that gets more out there, and if they do bring the cost price down on that, that is definitely a game changer. And it's something that scares the government, I think, because they do have such a stronghold on us with the oil and all of the price gouging that goes on.
Well, you know, why is gasoline $4 a gallon in California and $2.50 in New Jersey? Why is that? No, I don't get it.
They say
we're being manipulated. We're being used. We're being bled.
Yep.
America is the only economy in the world now that is on the verge of a big comeback, and somebody's gonna come along and fuck it up.
Yep.
I don't know what they're gonna do, but it's gonna have to do with oil.
Well, everyone is just become accustomed to supply and demand. It's to be expected.
Well, I'm driving a Prius until I can afford a Tesla.
Nice.
Nice.
Thank you. I actually drive a Prius myself, and I love it. I mean, the thing is cheap as hell, and I can go for days and days and days.
Yeah.
Hey, but look what they were saying in the beginning. Oh, those batteries will wear out. Oh, 50,000 miles. I've got 140,000 miles on my Prius.
Exactly.
Well, I mean, it's Toyota.
And it runs like fucking new. I haven't even got my brakes done yet.
That's great.
I have 140,000 miles. I'm not kidding.
Shit.
Yeah, because
at the end of the day, it's still a Toyota, and Toyota's fucking badass. I don't care. Everyone talks about American made. Well, you know what?
Well,
start making it better.
I burn half the electricity of everybody else, half the oil, gas of everybody else.
Yeah.
Come on. I get 500 miles to the tank.
That's ridiculous.
when they were charging $5 for gasoline, $5 a gallon.
Oh, yeah.
Those people with 20 gallons and 25 gallons, it's incredible. When you're spending over $100 to fill your car,
mm-hmm. Yep.
Come on. It should come with a driver.
Full release driver at that.
Yeah, I mean, I get people who make fun of me all the time about it. They're like, oh, you're a man, you shouldn't be driving a Prius. Really? Because this man is spending $22 every 12 to 14 days and getting double the gas mileage that your 20-gallon tank is taking, and I fill it up for 10 gallons.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Right. You got to do what you can do, I'm trying to figure out. I heard about this solar panel company, Solar for America.
Oh,
they're
yes.
manufactured in America. They're, it's owned by American veterans. And for like $15,000, I could get solar panels to power my house completely.
Wow.
I'll be off the grid.
Yeah.
So I just had to figure out how to get a mortgage on that in over 10 years,
Well, actually, you can sell your power back to the grid, too, though. That's one of the cool things about
it. Yeah. They don't make that easy, All the politicians are saying, you'll get a tax rebate, you'll get this, you'll get that. But I know people are trying to do it, and it's like, no, they really don't cooperate. You can get it done, but it's like dealing with the DMV or with the IRS. You're entitled to certain things, but it takes for fucking ever to get it.
Yeah, shit.
And that's the thing, too. I mean, with that going on with the solar panels, that they're really not going to boost that out there in the media, like CNN and all that, all the time or anything. Because, like you said, they're trying to keep the whole gas price going up, keeping the whole, us locked down with gas and demographics. So you find that article about something like that in some obscure website somewhere or an article in a magazine,
Yeah, well, there's different.
Hey, man, when you see the oil companies buying up the patents for all of these alternative energy devices, we're getting screwed.
The
government is supposed to protect us from that. The government should be saying, "Wait a minute, you're not buying it so you can produce it. You're buying it to keep it off the market. That's not right. That's not good for America."
Yeah, and that happens a lot. All these different.
I don't think the government should control individuals. But it should definitely control corporations.
Absolutely. Because let's be real.
This thing with the hydrogen highway. That shouldn't be allowed to keep that away from America. Why should we subsidize the solar energy and wind energy? The same reason you subsidize coal and oil. It's good for America.
Yep,
that's right.
Yeah, but it's not going to put money in their pockets, so they don't want to do it. It's kind of the same way like the FDA regulates our drugs that we take, because if it's something natural that they can't patent, then it's not going to get pushed through.
That is true.
Yeah, you're right. But, that's because our elected officials are owned and operated by the lobbyists.
Mm-hmm.
And
absolutely.
The lobbyists represent corporations. We're just getting fucked left and right by big money.
It's true.
It really is true. I mean, you got to turn around every time. I think that every person who runs for presidency should have like NASCAR clothing, and actually have like who's their lobbyist. Stickers all over them,
I don't think you should be allowed to be a professional politician.
Thank you.
Yeah, I agree with
you. I don't see anybody running, you know, or even talking about running for president that doesn't plan on making $1 billion from being president.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, the quickest way to become a billionaire in America is to run for president.
Yeah.
That's why I'm
not
sure.
Obama, you know, besides the whole fucking story about politics, Obama went to school on with financial aid and grants and government grants and all this other stuff, and now he's a billionaire.
Yeah.
You know, he was like, what, two short terms in the state senate of Illinois? You know, they had no fucking money. Now he's president, he's a billionaire.
Nope. Well, you know,
I wouldn't want to be president.
Yeah,
you know, after 7 years, he's a billionaire.
There was a strong agenda there he was after, it seems like.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
it's just amazing. It's just amazing that everybody knows this, but nobody does anything about it. Nobody can do anything about it. Absolutely. What can we do? There's nothing we can do.
Here's the problem, Mike. Here's the problem, is that mass amounts of people are fucking stupid. Everyone is lemmings, and they're just going to go with the flow, and they're going to go with whoever screams the loudest, and you have ignorant people that are leading those massive amounts of other people.
Yeah, the minority is leading the majority.
Yes.
Yes, that's a fact.
Well, you know, part of the problem is some stupid drug addict, you know, pothead, who, you know, isn't working, has no intention of working, isn't educating himself, that vote is worth the same as somebody who's gone to college, contributed to the good of the country and society. His vote is worth the same as somebody who's hoping to get a handout.
Yeah, exactly, and they're going to vote for, you know, their benefit to get,
like,
a handout.
They buy these votes. They buy these votes. It's like, listen, dudes, we're going to legalize marijuana, dudes. Oh, I'm voting for that guy.
Yeah. Because he's the same
guy.
Okay,
what else? We're going to legalize all drugs. Oh, I'm voting for that guy, dude. And you know what? Your subsidized, you know, your welfare is going to be just 20% beneath minimum wage. So you don't even need to work, man.
Yeah. We'll get you drugs and we'll pay you to stay home.
This is what brought down Europe, you know. Yeah. This is what brought down Europe. Is that the Social Security in Europe is 20% less than minimum wage. Because I lived there for 10 years. I know this firsthand.
Yeah.
Right? Wow. So you get these guys who have a hard time graduating from high school, and they think, well, you know, I just go on, you know, the social programs. They'll pay my rent. They'll subsidize my food. There's mass transit. Anything I make on the side, I don't pay taxes on. Why should I get a job? Why should I get a job? I'm better off not working.
Yeah, and it just perpetuates the problem, because now you have like 80% of the people doing 90% of the work, and you have that 20% who's doing nothing.
You think it's
or the other way around? The other way around.
Yeah, I was going to say, you might turn
the whole
around.
Community is voluntarily anesthetizing themselves.
Yes.
Yes.
You know, they're drinking too much. They're doing drugs, and they're just making themselves stupid, and they're being led around and misled by the government and corporations.
Yeah, because they're just the lemmings that are going to follow the bandwagon of what's the least amount that I can do and get the most out of it.
Kind of like what we do.
Yeah, it's like wasting their lives, you know, and America is the only country that's got shit happening now. Look at the Chinese stock market dropped by 35%. You know, that talk about the bubble economy. At any second, you know, there's going to be another revolution there.
Mm.
Any second now. You know, my brother is, what do you call that? He investigates companies for investment.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. You know, like Wall Street guys, right?
Right.
And he says that they're putting up cities the size of San Diego in 5 years. In 5 years, they're having a city the size of San Diego, but nobody can move in. Nobody can afford to live there. So they have all of these skeleton cities, these empty cities.
Yeah, I've seen that on shows that they document.
Oh, you saw that on Vice or something, right?
Yeah.
Vice. Yep. Vice is one of the best shows in the world until they got bought by somebody big, right? Now they work for somebody.
Yeah, now they have an agenda.
In the beginning, you have these young Canadian guys exposing all of this hypocrisy in the world, and now, and we'll see.
Yeah. Now someone owns them, so we'll see what they actually get out.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Let's see if they continue, or if they're gonna, you know, have to start doing what, you know, what they're told. Somehow, I don't think they will. You know, like those guys who made South Park, they were so cool. When they said, you had to do this, they quit.
Yep,
yeah,
yep.
You know, they said, and we won't do it. And that's, you know, that was a great thing that they did that. We'll give you millions and millions of dollars. They said, no, that's not why we got into it. We already have millions.
Yeah.
You know, how many millions do I need? You know, it's just fantastic. I'm hoping that's what the guys from Vice are going to do.
Yeah, hopefully.
They seem like it. They're young guys, you know, and, you know, they don't have anything to lose. They've already got a mountain of money. And obviously they went into this, you know, to wake up the planet.
Yeah, and see, we do that actually with our show. We have a segment called Legit or Bullshit, where we take an article, whether it's about aliens, anything paranormal, conspiracy theory, so on and so forth, and we vote if it's legit or bullshit, because we're reaching for the truth out there.
Right.
And that's, yeah, that's a lot of...
Like that guy, the great Randy, right?
Yeah.
Was that magician who was exposing all the magicians?
Oh, yes. Yes. Yep. Absolutely.
Yeah, I love those shows.
Yeah,
Randy the Magnificent.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, so... We'll get these stories stuff, in and articles. Know? Yeah, we get these stories and articles in, and then we take a vote and we do legit or bullshit, and then we play off the topic. We give our reasons why we hate or think it's legit or bullshit.
Yeah.
And that's what we're doing with the direction of this show. That's why I'm so glad that you're talking about all these points in politics and everything else and conspiracy theories, because you're bringing some truth to this show. It's awesome. I love it.
And let me ask your opinion on something. The Wall Street outage that just happened recently. What are your thoughts on that? What do you think was the actual cause of that?
Yeah, how about that, man, huh?
Yeah.
Now, we're talking some very serious young hackers out there. I don't know if it's China or Korea or just some wildcats, you know. But, you know, let's see. United Airlines, the Wall Street Journal, and the stock market all shut down, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the next day it was Ameritrade that got hacked. You know, it's like, wow. And, you know, and this WikiLeaks stuff, you know, this guy Snowden. Oh, wow, yes. Man, it's wild what's going on. And this is the internet, and this is young people who aren't afraid.
Exactly.
You know, and I hope they don't start disappearing is all.
Hey, you got to keep the government on their toes. Yeah, the Snowden thing, too, that you mentioned. I mean, that we have people that call him a traitor, but he gave up so much to do what he did.
It really is. It's down the line. Some people call him traitor. Yeah, some people call him a hero.
Yeah.
France, you would expect France would have given him asylum, right? But they didn't.
Yeah.
You know, I'm surprised. Because the French are, you know, up to people and all that other crap, you know, with the French Revolution. But they didn't give him asylum. And you got to realize, the French are owned and operated by, you know, the euro.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's a very worrisome time right now, guys. But listen, we've been on the phone for a little over half an hour, and I'm pulling into where I'm going.
All right.
I got to beat it.
Thanks for calling in, Mike.
Before you go, would you mind giving us a little soundbite?
What do you mean? What do you want me to say?
Just, this is Michael Perret, and you're listening to the guys of DeadX Radio.
How do you say it? Say it slower.
This is Michael Perret, and you're listening to the Bad Boys of the Paranormal on DeadX Radio.
Okay, ready?
Go ahead.
Okay, hi, this is Michael Pare, and you're listening to the Bad Boys on Bad X Radio.
All right.
Perfect. Thank Perfect. You, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mike.
It was a pleasure having you on, guy.
Yeah, very much a pleasure. Thank you.
All right. Later, bye.
Bye.
Wow.
Fantastic. Wow, that was awesome.
That was cool.
Wow.
That was definitely
yeah.
cool.
Yeah.
The one thing I love about our program is when we have people come on, we let them talk about them.
Yeah, yes. Absolutely.
You know what I mean? And what their interests are. Not just what we want to hear from them, and you know, but what do they want to talk about?
Right. Absolutely.
You know, and like Michael Pare, I mean, it was touching so many subjects about, I mean, from conspiracy theories to politics, you know, to big money, to corporations.
Energy.
Right. Energy. I mean, you yes. name aliens. I mean, he went all around the board, and the man knows his
shit. And I just want to say one thing to all three of you. Fuck you, fuck you, fuck you for making fun of me for driving a Prius.
Okay. I'm still going to make fun of you for driving a Prius. It doesn't matter. But you know what? It's a great car, Sean, actually.
The one thing that really stuck out, I mean, yeah, okay, you know, we now know that Michael Pare drives a Prius, but that's great. But he spoke intelligently on every single subject that he said.
Yes.
He did not stammer. He did not have any question. He knew specifics. He didn't just give an opinion that was a blanket opinion on something. He had a very specific
reason as to why.
Details. Yes, that's everything he said.
That's right. A man who, one, does his homework, And number two, he obviously has passion in these subjects. Yes. I mean, which plays off into his film work. You know what I mean? I mean, when he's doing a role, he's immersed in that role. Yeah, he becomes that individual in that
yes,
film.
Yes, he does.
I agree.
You know, and you can see it from his memorization of everything, of like, you know, the points he was touching on and everything else, and then talking about the films. I can see why he's a great actor.
Yeah.
Yeah. He definitely was just a pleasure to have on. I mean, it was... wow.
Yeah.
I just talked to one of my childhood heroes. That's pretty
insane. Same for me. I mean, Jeff and I were sitting around last night, and Sean...
In our underwear.
In our underwear.
I'm just kidding.
You know, eating popcorn.
I believe that. I wasn't there. Underwear. I was at work.
I was not in underwear. I'll clarify that.
But all kidding aside, you know, three of us were sitting around last night. We're putting together the production for the show today, and we're talking. And we kept talking about, we can't believe we have Michael Pare coming on, who is a big hero of, like, me and Jeff's especially, you know, when we were younger. Greatest American Hero is one of my favorite TV shows when I was a kid. You know, and then moving on up to, you know, Eddie the Cruiser, one of my favorite movies, Eddie and the Cruisers 2, Philadelphia Experiment.
Right.
You know, Streets of Fire. I mean,
Hope Floats?
I actually like Hope Floats because I have a huge crush on Sandra Bullock.
Yeah, me too.
I caught Eddie and the Cruisers a little bit later. I think it was about like 8 or 10 years old, somewhere in there. But still, yeah, that was like one of the movies that I remember.
Very cool.
When I was growing up, cool being movie. That young and actually being able to remember that movie was awesome.
See, I wish that I would have actually thought about him being in Hope Floats, because the girl I was dating at the time forced me to watch it, and it was miserable. It was brutal.
John had texted me and asked if he had remembered him, you know, from the film. You know, and I said, yes, he did remember you, you know. John's listening currently, you know, on the show. He's listening to us, and he loved the interview. Thought it was awesome.
Awesome.
Yeah,
thank you.
It's a very clean sound today.
And just as an extra little shout out for Mr. John Rusnak, he is a sexy, sexy motherfucker. So, and he's a very good movie maker.
These are the guys in the underwear. Don't forget that, folks.
Yeah, absolutely. These two, right here.
Yeah, these two. I'll go with you there, Sean. Cheers.
Hurrah. Cheers. Hurrah.
All right, so that was a... wow, it was a really good interview. So, wow.
Are we going to take a break before our next guest?
You know what? I think that I would love to take a break, but really what we're doing is we're going to run. We did a little skit, okay? We have a little bit that we're starting, and it's ghost hunting with Mike Tyson. We have the actual fake Mike Tyson.
Fake
Mike. Who is doing ghost hunting for us now. And we send him out on these adventures. And, well, you know, you'll get to get the full experience of Mr. Mike Tyson's ghost adventure right now.
Welcome to Ghost Hunting with Mike Tyson.
Hey, everybody. It's me, Mike Tyson. Well, I'm standing outside of the place the guys from DeadX Radio sent me to. And let me tell you, this place looks scary as fuck. And it's huge, too. There's even a graveyard here.
It's really not that scary, Mike. We would not send you into something that you would get hurt with.
I don't know, man. This place is pretty creepy looking.
Yeah, but you gotta go inside. You promised us you would do this.
Hmm?
Mike, if you do this for us, we will take you to Sizzler afterwards.
It's all-you-can-eat buffet night.
Alright, yeah. I remember. Okay, let me grab some of this stuff. First of all, here we have the EMF.
EMF?
EMF?
Yeah, the electromagnetic dejector.
EMF.
Yeah, the EMF.
Okay, that spells EMF.
Okay, that works.
So let me just grab all this stuff and we'll go inside.
Now remember, Mike, this is radio, so you're going to have to describe what you see so that way the listeners can get a visual of what you're actually interacting with.
Okay, I got it. So you want me to describe everything for everybody to see so, like, they're in the room with me. Well, we're inside. Hello? Hello? Is anyone there? No? Okay, it doesn't sound like anyone's in here. But I'm in a big round room with paintings that are all around the place. And holy shit, they're starting to stretch. And the room is freaking moving. I'm out of here.
Mike. No, don't leave. You gotta finish this. We promised we would take you to Sizzler. When we get done with this, you have to do this. Just try to go a little bit further into the house. You don't have to go all the way. Just a little bit further for us.
Okay, a little bit further. That's it. If I get too freaked out, I'm going to leave, though. All right, so there's some sort of weird train-like thing with some carts. I guess I'm going to get on them and see where it goes.
They got a train in their house. Man, this must be a huge place. They've got to be rich.
Wow. We need to get to know them so they can fund our show.
Absolutely. So, Mike, all right, so you're on this train and you're going right now. What are you seeing? I mean, tell us, what are you seeing right now?
Well, we went up a hill, and we're in some sort of hallway, which is really weird because the doors and the walls are all breathing, and at the end of the hallway is this floating candlestick, and it's really freaking me out.
Are you getting all this on camera?
Camera? I didn't know we had a camera.
The little square thing, it's got the light on top. It says camera on the bag.
I don't know how to read.
Okay, well, don't worry about that right now. Chance, are you hearing all this stuff? I mean, I think we should go back and investigate this place ourselves. It sounds pretty intense.
Absolutely, it's freaking insane. I mean, you got doors breathing, you got freaking candles flying down the end of the hallway. This is insane.
So, talk to me, what else are you seeing?
Well, right now we just went around the corner, and it just opened up to this big, huge, like, dance floor, ballroom kind of thing. And, holy shit. There's a bunch of ghosts and they're all dancing. I'm freaking out, man.
Dancing ghosts?
You can actually see them.
They are dancing.
So wait, full apparition ghosts are dancing in front of you.
That's right. Full partition ghosts are dancing in front of me.
I can't believe this. He's seen full-bodied apparitions. We have to go investigate this.
I have never personally seen a full-body apparition, and I've been dying to. On all the investigations, that's like one of the things, the key things that I've been...
Guys, there's a huge ghost sitting right next to me. I see him in the mirror. I'm out of here.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for coming to Disney's Haunted Mansion.
Holy shit, a giant mouse.
Oh, no, don't hit me.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the show. I'm sitting in here alone because everyone else smokes, and I'm the only non-smoker of the group. And they're all idiots, but that's okay because I'm going to live longer than they will. So I'm just going to run with this myself. So if you would like to call in, we have our call-in number that we have not put out at all this episode because we've had Michael Pare calling in, which was a great interview. So if you missed it, then you suck and you missed everything that was great. But our phone number on the screen right now, area code 727-386-9356. Call into the show and I'll have you right here. And we are talking about UFOs today.
UFOs, that is definitely the topic for the day.
So, Sean.
Yes.
Have you ever personally seen a UFO?
I have, actually.
Tell me about that.
Actually, the first experience that I ever had with UFOs was actually my father talking about it when he was in the Air Force. But just coincidentally, when I was stationed in Japan, we were at the fire station one night. And my tech sergeant, Sergeant Carl Wiegand, he had told us that he had had some experiences. So we were outside, just outside underneath the barbecue pit. And me, myself and another guy had gone back inside. And he came running in. He was like, yo, you guys got to come out here and look at this. So we're like, what is he talking about? You know, we're thinking he's just pulling our leg or whatever. Well, we go out there and he's like, check this out. And we look up above the flight line, which was actually a true north-south runway, which was a 1836 runway. So a true north-south. And above the flight line on the, I believe it was the north end of the flight line, there was four white orbs, I guess that would you would call them. They were just circular objects up in the sky that were going around in a circular 360 pattern. And then every once in a while, one would break off and disappear, just shoot out, pew, gone. We're like, what the hell? We're thinking at first, you know, we're thinking, okay, maybe it's spotlights from downtown somewhere, but we're watching and we don't see the classic spotlight beam going up where it's, you know, going around and you can actually follow the beam from where it's being traced from. Mm-hmm. Well, as we're watching these things, they start changing color. They start going green, red, yellow, blue. And it was almost as if they were interacting with each other, like a communication of some sort.
Actually, Sean, I remember having a conversation with you because I seen something similar in Brooksville, Florida. When I lived on that 5 acres, that farm,
right.
And I seen kind of the same thing, and it was, it's something to behold, and it's very freaky, because you can't explain it.
And the freakiest part of it was that we had security forces actually drove up, which is like the on-base police department.
Pat's date just arrived.
Yes, she sure did. And they were like, oh, what are you guys looking at? And we told them, they're like, oh, that's nothing, go back inside, nothing to worry about. And we're like, you know, any other night of the week, we had been out there plenty of times, and they would drive by and say, hey, what's up, guys? And we tell them, and that's it. That's the extent of their conversation with us. That was the extent of their conversation with us. That was it. Yeah.
We just had a sighting in the studio here.
But, you know, so they kind of were like, oh, no, that's nothing. It's from down in Yokohama.
We have a caller. Let's see who this is.
We have a caller.
All right.
Hello, you're live on DeadX Radio. How can I help you?
Hello?
Yes.
Hey, this is Zach Webb, actually, Pat's son.
Zach Webb, Pat's son. Zach Webb. All right. Zach Webb, you are live on the air with us.
Hello. I just wanted to say this also. My dad's story that he was just saying in Brooksville about the two UFOs that we had saw.
Yes.
Actually, one of them actually did shoot something at the other UFO, which was actually pretty cool. Because, I mean, at that point, I was very young, but I remember it vividly. And there was more than just me and my dad. I mean, we were actually having a party there with a bunch of people. And
you had to say party, son, right?
Yeah. And we had actually came out, and we all actually saw this happening.
Yes.
Now, my question to you guys is what you think about, like battles that could happen with the UFOs.
I think if UFOs are coming to Earth to battle out each other, then Earth is more screwed than we know, because they're like probably going to destroy us while destroying each other.
Yeah, because let's look at it realistically. If they got that kind of technology to travel that far from where they came from,
right,
and do what they're going to do with that kind of weaponry, which we are sure is obviously advanced, then, I mean, I don't picture UFOs throwing rocks at each other. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
At that point, we're nothing but a decimated playground caught in the middle.
Right. Exactly.
That night, I don't particularly think that we were watching a battle per se, and I don't think Sean's version of Japan, right?
That wasn't Japan.
It was Japan.
Correct.
Okay. I just want to make sure I was right. I don't think that we were actually watching it. I think there was a communication going on. I think something was changed over to another craft. Is what I believe we were watching that particular night. But, something. And, I think
you... That's very possible.
And you know what's so funny, Zach, is I think you were, like, what, 8?
But what about... Because I remember also that one did just disappear, and then just the one was left after it happened.
After it had received,
the one had completely disappeared, and then the one was there, and then that one finally shot off.
That's true. And shot off. And he's not kidding. It just... light speed.
That's the experience that we had, that these crafts, if I guess that's what I'm going to call them, the ones that were disappearing, that were breaking formation, I mean, they were gone in the split second of an eye. I mean, yes. It was like, boom, gone. And then they would return.
Oh, yeah.
And that was the weirdest thing, is that the other ones that were left were still doing this 360 rotation deal. And they would just come back and join right back in like they had never skipped a beat. So what they were going off and doing, who the heck knows? The same ones that my father saw up in Minot, North Dakota, when he was traveling back to base. They were, both of the crafts were parallel to his vehicle, but they were a distance out. But as soon as they got within a certain distance from the base, they were like, pew, gone.
Gone. Yeah. So was I right, Zach? I mean, what were you, like 8 when we lived in Brooksville?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I was young, but I don't remember how old.
Yeah. He's 9 now, right, folks. I just want to let you know. I'm looking at it.
But yeah, definitely interesting that, you know, you actually saw something get passed, because actually Jeff had brought up a video a couple weeks ago that he had shared on Facebook, where there was actually a guy who was out in his yard or something. He was like, it almost looked like a handheld camera, like the old style handheld camera.
Should have pulled that video in for the show.
And it was shooting what can only be described as like plasma balls or something like that. It was actually
plasma balls.
Yeah, it was actually shooting something.
Maybe that's what we saw that night, Zach. Plasma balls.
And what was interesting about it is that when these things, whatever it was shooting out, was like getting to a certain point, it was actually leaving like vapor rings.
Okay.
From where it was actually traveling through the sky.
Yeah, but did it attach to anything? Or
no,
it was just shooting out into
random...
I think I saw that video you posted.
Yeah, it was... Into random sky.
Yeah, that was kind of trippy.
It was really weird.
The thing I'm wondering about, too, because when we just touched on the topic a minute ago about if an alien race came here against another alien race and they had this war on our planet, my question is everyone pretty much on the planet damn near has seen the movie Armageddon with Bruce Willis.
Right.
Yes.
And you remember where he made the comment about NASA not being prepared for this asteroid hitting? He was like, you know, don't you guys have a group of guys that sit around just thinking shit up? That's all their job is, to think shit up.
Right.
Well, it makes me wonder, like, you know, do we or any other country on this planet have a contingency plan if aliens were to attack?
I think we do.
I think we
really
have people
do
that sit around and think shit. We do.
Like, prime example. example was like this couple years ago with a guy in Miami who chewed the dude's face off, and right. this whole span right. about Walking Dead was starting to come out and get real popular. Yes. You right. know, about a zombie apocalypse.
Right. Yes. Exactly.
And then CDC made a joke of it and basically said, you know, here's a zombie survival guide.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, way granted, to take that away from UFOs.
Yeah.
That
now,
chance,
granted, the truth behind that is with the CDC is it's just pretty much it's just a preparation kit. It's you could use that during a case of hurricanes, so right. on and so forth.
Right.
But they figured it'd be entertaining and great for people to see because Walking Dead was so huge and everything else that we'll say it's a zombie survival guide, basically. Now, since they did that, though, I'm just like you were just touching on, or Sean, you were just talking about, is, do we have a contingency plan? And, I would love to get my hands on that and actually see it.
Yes, I absolutely yes. 100% believe that there is a contingency
plan. No more Mike's
Hard
Lemonade for you.
They have Psalm 101 that describes these biological entities that, like I said last week, I think that document is 100% legit. So if they have this document, that states, okay, these are the types of crafts and this is how you go about cleaning it up, well, I believe this is also a situation that would require us to also be prepared just in case they come guns a-blazing,
yeah.
ready to say, hey, guess what, motherfuckers? We've been studying you for the past 50, 60 years. Now we've got all the information we need. Now it's time to take you over.
We brought forth the Kardashians and Kanye to confuse you.
All right.
Zach, you still on the phone with us?
Yes, I am. I'll let you guys go. Finish your show.
Hey, thanks for calling
show, by the way.
All right.
Thank you.
Hey, no problem.
I love you, son.
And all right, love you too, Father, and
Father?
Catch you guys some other time.
Father.
All right, see
bye,
you later,
Zach.
Buddy.
That's right, Father Patrick X.
That's thank you, Father.
Domino's Nabisco Shredded Wheat.
See, now what we've done is we've actually scared the shit out of everyone watching because they're like, holy shit, this man has reproduced.
Wait a minute, there's aliens attacking the Earth. I'm not concerned about that. What did they say, that X had a child?
Yeah, that's going to be on one of
the panic sets in.
But let's carry on with the panic situation here and things coming from space. This is big around in all the articles right now.
Right,
all
these asteroid.
The asteroid is supposed to be hitting in September. Now, the funny thing is, every fucking year, there's an article about an asteroid
right.
going that's to collide with us like, that year.
Right.
It's always around September, November. Is it something about the holiday season they fucking hate? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably...
Hey, they hate my birthday. That's what it is.
Look, Christmas right around the corner. Let's fuck it up.
Right, you know? But I mean, realistically, let's think about it. We are floating in the middle of space. There's shit that's flying at us all the time. It's happened once. It happened during the dinosaurs that we know of 100% because that's what they... Yeah. Granted, there's the whole Big Bang theory versus this theory, whatever, blah, blah, blah. But we've got craters on this planet.
Blah, 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 blah. I just wanted to note that.
But, there's craters that we know for fact that have been created by... massive asteroids that have
absolutely.
Hit the planet.
You got Crater Lake up in Oregon.
Right.
Crater
so
Lake was
why would we be so stupid?
Grand Canyon.
Why would we be so stupid to think that it couldn't happen again?
Well, the like scientists were, from
Japan,
allegedly from NASA, from this article I read, was stating back that yes, an asteroid will eventually hit the Earth, like 100,000 years from now.
Right.
It's going to be way off in the distance future. That's not an exact time, guys. Don't start setting your calendars. I'm just saying it's going to be
I
off.
I am setting by my chance. Clocks right now.
Right now.
Yes.
Right now, there's some guy out there going, I've only got 100,000 years to prepare.
Right.
Martha, do we have enough spam in the cupboard?
Yeah, because at that point, I'm sorry, if an asteroid's going to hit, in say 100,000 years, I'm going to be dead. I don't care.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
If
you tell me 100 days, I'm a little edgy.
A little difference.
Yeah. I'll be worried.
A little bit of a small difference.
But you know what? With that being said, let's say that the government, NASA, whoever, just some big organization out there got wind of an impending attack from an alien race or an impending asteroid that's going to hit this planet and cause global devastation. Do you think they would tell us?
No.
No.
Okay, Jeff, what's your reasoning?
Okay, here's the thing about that. If something like that was going to go down, the government does not want panicky people. They already have provisions set aside for the select elect few.
The upper echelon.
The upper echelon to be able to be taken care of. And they're going to choose, kind of like in all the movies. I mean, it really makes sense. Okay, we want some artists here. We want people to continue our society forward for when everyone else gets wiped away. Now, I know me personally, if I were the government, then there's only a select few people I would want with me.
We will be in the entertainment wing at X Radio. Yeah.
Well, not
everyone. I think we're pretty screwed.
Not everyone at this table. Not everyone at the table is going to be making
Sorry,
my Tyndall. List.
I'm taking the head with me, though.
Yeah, you can have it. Yeah. You can have it.
Well, it's because you don't get head any other way.
My thing behind it is absolutely...
Don't make me put the foot up your
absolutely
ass.
Absolutely not.
It's Bigfoot.
Absolutely not. Like, I'm going along the lines of Jeff's route here. They don't want panic. They don't want that mass hysteria. I mean, just the other last week when 4th of July happened, I had to leave where we were broadcasting from and go home and come back to where we had been. But in the process, there was a July 4th celebration that was happening in an area. And... just that's, and it was a small celebration in retrospect to how many people we have on the planet and just in that town alone. And there was absolute controlled chaos just in that little tiny area. There was so much, like, I mean, the police had to basically tell the, you know, the lights were going red, yellow, green, and telling everybody, no, we got to get these people out. That was just a small group of people, and it was just
to watch fireworks,
right? And it was just like, holy shit! Imagine if the police force wasn't part of this, because they were like, screw this, I got to get my family out too. And there's no police force, there's no military force to take care of that. There's absolute fucking panic, and that's the only way to describe it, because
there is so much truth behind that. There really is. And think about this. Remember, it was just a few years ago, I believe it was Great White that had the concert they were giving.
Yes.
The building caught on fire,
right?
And yes, a bunch of people had died. And the reason why, like, a handful of people ran toward one certain emergency exit, and everybody, you know, they call the cattle effect, followed suit.
Right.
Everybody was blocked in, and people who realize it's locked, we can't go out, is trying to turn around, they can't even turn around.
They can't because of the pressure and the force of everybody else pushing against them.
And a bunch of people had gotten injured and died, like, unfortunately.
That's why I'm grabbing my backpack, my M16, and my 9mm. Motherfucker, you follow me into a situation, I'm fighting my way out one way or another. You know? I'm punching you, I'm shooting you, I don't care. It's mass panic.
I'm on Sean's martial team.
Law. Yes.
Yeah. You can just put that out there now.
Yeah, we're on Team Sean.
Yes. Martial law, bitch, because it's coming through.
Rock on.
And right now, FBI is listening to the program. And recording.
Don't worry, it's all legal.
Not till martial law is in place.
That's right.
Yeah.
And then it's this all legal.
Oh.
Well, it is on my side of the flag, that's yes, for damn sure.
Exactly.
All right, so hypothetically, let's say that an alien race, because we're talking about aliens today.
Right.
Let's say an alien race is coming. The government decided, you know what, there's too many people who found out about it. They're spreading it. Fuck it. Let's tell them. They tell us there's an impending alien race coming, and they mean to do us harm.
So have they made their declarations clear? Like, hey, we've made contact with Earth.
Yes.
And this is what we said. We're coming. We're taking you over. We're shooting you. We're killing you. And we're enslaving you.
I'd like to say that I am President Obama, and I just want to know, what do you plan on doing?
We're going to kick your ass.
Okay, fair
enough. Okay, yeah, guys, roll them. You
know, okay, so
that happens.
Hold on. I have a question for you. Okay,
shoot.
So in this hypothetical situation, where is the government on our side or the alien side?
At the moment, we'll say they're on our side. Hence why they're going to tell us all that the impending race is coming to destroy us.
Got it.
Now, at that point in juncture, are you going to follow what the government tells you to do, or are you just going to choose to go out on your own and hope for the best?
No,
Jeff,
I'm...
you first.
Okay.
All right, so here's the thing. The government telling us to do something...
Yeah, they're saying go to the shelters like they always do with hurricanes.
Okay, so go to the shelters and everything like that. First of all, anytime I've lived in Florida, you know, many, many years...
We've all been through this, yeah.
And we've all been through the whole thing. Okay, go to the shelters. I've never gone to the shelters.
Yeah, neither have I.
Never have. And now I know it can be, you know, considered stupid because if a hurricane comes through and just wipes us out or whatever, but we live in Tampa. In Tampa, really, hurricanes go around us.
Yes.
You know, so it's just the way it is. So we, I guess, can be considered a little bit stupid like that because we're too comfortable in that. And I think that as a society, we get comfortable. People think, oh, well, I'm not going to die. I can drive drunk and I can, you know, do these stupid things and I'm not going to die, you know, because we have that arrogance about ourselves. So that being said, me, myself, will I follow what the government says? I think I'd have to analyze the specific details of what they said. If it makes sense, then I may do part of it, but I'm not really prepared to, you know, grab my guns and like go out in the mountains and, you know, live off the land.
Yeah, or barricade yourself near a house
whatever.
Or apartment.
Anything
or whatever.
Like that. I mean, I think there would have to be like a massive, extreme, just big thing that happens. It kind of starts wiping out society. At that point, maybe I'm like, okay, fuck this shit. I'm out of here.
Yep.
You know, I could get there. I'm not going to default to that right away. I think that anyone that makes any kind of knee-jerk fast reaction to anything is just ignorant. I mean, you have to like analyze what's really going on and make an educated decision.
Okay. Patrick?
I like Pat's survival guide the best because I don't trust my government.
Okay.
Period. I'd probably be calling Sean for his guns, you know, and following him in whatever parade we were about to head into. But no, honestly, at this point, if we had an evading alien race and anything like that was going, I would probably put my cards on. I would take care of myself and my family, because that's the most important thing to me, is my family. And I could give a rat's ass about what Obama, any other government official or anything has to say about the well-being of my fucking family. You know what I mean? Honestly.
Okay. All right. Good answer. All right. For me, I have a basic rule of thumb. When in doubt, get the fuck out.
Right? That's a good rule of thumb.
And here's the reason why. Because if an alien species is coming here to decimate us off this planet, you don't think they haven't been observing us for quite a while? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just, it's the normal military tactic, is recon first before you go in and do your job. You know, do the deed. So with that being said, I don't want to follow anything they're going to be doing, because more than likely, they probably already fucking know about it. You know what I mean? So let's do the opposite. Let's take off and go to Sean's house, get some popcorn, throw in some reruns of, you know, Baywatch, and fucking hang out. You know what I mean? Wait and figure out what we're going to do from there and make the next plan.
Is it going to be Baywatch?
I'm just... Well, okay. So dude, I used to have a huge crush on Pamela Anderson, and I love the water, so they kind of coincide.
So two words for that question, followed by more words, is absolutely not. Okay, I'm not following the government's word whatso-fucking-ever. Mm-hmm. Like you said, they're A, recon. B, the government doesn't know shit about what exactly is about to occur. They may think they have a plan, they may think they have knowledge, but really, let's face it, has an alien race come down here and really showed its hand as far as full power and what they can do? No.
Well, absolutely.
So therefore,
Roswell crash.
I'm grabbing my shit, I'm getting the fuck out, and I'm getting out before everybody else can.
Yeah.
And I'm going to Falling Skies this motherfucker, and I'm going to go live in the woods, and I'm going to become a rebel force, and we're going to get an army together, and we're going to take them down one by one.
I will come visit your place in the woods. You let me know where it's at, because I'll come visit you after I know for sure, but I'm not going to go there right away.
I will send a dove with a note.
And right now, there's a...
I'm sending a donkey your way.
And hold on, and actually, truth be known, right now is a future director or producer out there writing, okay, don't believe the government, they're going to run in the woods and hide, oh, it's going to be a great movie,
right? Yes. You know,
remember, our show is copywritten, and we do
it's trademark,
it's intellectual property.
Well, intellectual is kind of a stretch.
Hey, that's a stretch. That's for sure.
All right, so okay, alien race attacks, what provisions would you bring with you, Pat? You get three things.
I get three things.
Oh, we have another caller. Oh, call up, okay, right, okay, now.
Hold on.
Let's see who we got.
Saved by the Bell.
You are on live with Dead X Radio.
Tom Matthews.
Wow. Film icon. One of the heroes of my childhood. You scared me. How are you doing today?
That's not hard to do, Tom.
No, it's not.
I'm well.
So where are you at currently right now?
Right now, I'm at Dana Point, California, south of, just north of San Diego, south of Los Angeles.
Nice.
Awesome. I have to go ahead and start this off. This is Chance, and I have to start this off, one, by saying thank you for coming on our show. And then number two is, you are like one of my... Okay, Return of the Living Dead 2 is one of my all-time favorite horror films. I am a huge horror buff. And when you agreed to do the show, I'm not going to lie, I did a happy dance in the living room. I was happy.
He did. It was that within itself was scary too.
Yeah, this is Patrick. I'm glad you didn't see it.
I hope you guys have video in that recording studio. Yeah. I want to see everything.
Hey, do the happy dance. Let's make Chance recreate the happy dance, okay, Tom? Hold on.
Yeah, because everybody actually can see us in studio.
Yes, they can see us in studio.
I was doing the little spin going.
Oh,
that was weak.
I'm glad you couldn't see that.
Yeah, that was pretty bad. It was pretty bad.
Watch the rerun.
Anyway, so Tom, I have a question for you. On set, you keep hearing all these stories about weird things that have happened while filming some of these horror movies. Have you personally experienced any of those on any of the projects you've been on?
For give me an example. I don't...
Well, they like
paranormal.
On the Exorcist show or I'm sorry, movie. The rooms would like randomly catch on fire, things like that.
Oh yeah, no, we didn't really experience anything like that. Not on the days that I was there.
And it was a zombie movie. Remember that, Jeff?
Yeah, well, okay,
yeah, it was right. A zombie movie. So,
but
yeah.
Still, any types of movies like that.
Not supernatural.
No, pretty just going to work.
Going to work.
So what project are you currently working on now?
No, I haven't acted in well, I did a reshoot of a movie I did 15 years ago, about a couple of years ago.
Oh, yeah?
Long story, it's called Letter to Dad, but I've just been raising my kids and running my business and stuff like that.
Doing the home life and taking a break and being a real person for a while, huh?
Exactly.
That's got to be an awesome feeling for you.
So did you enjoy being in the limelight, or are you more happy just to kind of stay in low key?
A little bit of both. You know, I didn't mind doing it up to a certain point. I'm certainly enjoying my kids, and they're getting older now, so I might get back into it for a little bit.
Oh, good. Well, I look forward to that. Now, like the Returning of the Living Dead movies, they say they're kind of based on actual true events, like, you know, the government had the, you know, toxic chemicals that were leaked out and, you know, bodies.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Well, what are your thoughts on that?
Whether it's true or not, who knows? I'm sure there's so much we don't even know about that the government knows about.
Yeah, I was going to say, some of the things I like from like Return of the Living Dead and Return of the Living Dead 2 is your comedic timing as well. And a lot of people like, you know, yes, it's an outstanding horror film, but there's so much comedy involved too. You know, and watching you and your role, I mean, it was hilarious. Some of the stuff, like, you know, when you're like, I can smell your brains, you know, in like part two, just awesome. You know, so like, do you still like feel like you were more of a comedic roles, you know, or more of like the action, you know, doing the horror?
No, I think the best comedy comes out of real life situations, and a lot of it had to do with the writing that, you know, Dan did, and he also was able to let us, you know, improvise and do our own thing and kind of work off of each other. And, you know, my connection with Jimmy Cairn was really a great one. And I don't know, you know, we have the same birthday. We both were born on November 28th, so I don't know if that has anything to do with it. but you know, Dan was great. He just let us go with it. And, you know, he wrote it and directed it, which is kind of a tough thing for a director to do and a writer, to let go of his words that he worked so many years working on, and then, you know, using the actors that he had hired and letting them use themselves to make it a better, translate better for everybody.
That's good. So speaking of that, what is your favorite project that you've actually worked on?
I'd have to say it was Return of the Living Dead, because I was one of the first. It was the biggest part at the time, and the experience for me was a really great one, only because I discovered years later, again, going back to Dan O'Bannon, letting us be very collaborative in the process, and I found out that doesn't happen all the time. It probably happens 5% of the time. So
you got spoiled on your first project.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. I did. So I kind of, that's probably, one of the best, most memorable experiences I had.
So what do you think?
I've been lucky. I've been all over the world shooting stuff. So I probably wouldn't have gone to these places otherwise, or even left California, but I did, and I have a lot of things to draw on. So, it was a great experience.
Now, do you consider yourself an actual zombie film buff? I mean, do you really like the genre, or was this just kind of something that you enjoyed doing?
Something I really enjoyed doing, and I had no idea the pulp culture that it was going to create. I mean,
exactly.
Nowadays, whenever You hear it all over the place. Whenever the zombies are going for brains, Return of the Living Dead. So
yes,
and that's what my kids were watching. 2 years ago, the zombies were going after the brain, so it just kind of put a smile on my face.
I know where they got
that
from.
Who knew?
And that's, you bring that up too. It's I watch a show called Walking Dead, and the zombies they have in that actually pay homage to Return of the Living Dead. They have specific zombies that they will recreate for episodes.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Now,
fantastic. Yeah, I've seen a couple episodes of the show. I think it's really, really, really well made.
Yes.
Definitely.
With that being said, too, I mean, being on Return of the Living Dead, Return of the Living Dead 2, you know, like you were saying, it became a pop culture film. You know, it became a huge film in the horror industry. But, like, some people, they correlate, you know, that I talk to, friends of mine, you know, I'm not saying out there in general, but friends, who always, when they hear your name, they instantly, like you said, they say brains, or they're like, oh, you know, from Return of the Living Dead. But also, too, another iconic franchise of horror films was Friday the 13th, and you were in Friday the 13th Part 6.
Right.
Yeah, and so for between those two genres of horror films, which was your favorite one to do, the Friday the 13th or over back at Return of the Living Dead?
I think for me it was Return of the Living Dead, just because it was so genius how it turned out. You know, again, the humor came out of the situation. I mean, when we were cut. We had that. You had a yellow corpse down on the ground. We're cutting off its head. I remember watching it, and I was horrified but laughing at the same time. And I have never felt that experience in another movie in my life.
That's great.
I was like, I couldn't watch it, but I kept turning my head to see what was going on and laughing at the same time.
And then you feel bad.
It was bizarre. Yeah, and just, I mean, the music and the energy of the film, and it was just, the whole thing was just great.
Oh, yeah, the soundtrack.
It still holds up. I mean, I could still watch it and go, wow, this is still a good movie.
Yeah.
You know, it's not dated, it's except for the clothes. Some of the clothes.
Yeah, the wardrobe.
But it's a really solid movie.
Yeah, you're right. And when a movie can stand the test of time, that's when you know that it's a classic that is going to live on for even many years to come.
Exactly, yeah. You're right.
So hypothetically, let's say they decided to do a new version of, say, Return of the Living Dead. Would you do a cameo in that film?
Oh, sure. I'd certainly look at it, and it'd be, you know, if the story was right and everything else, I'd certainly look at it. That would be great.
Now, would you?
I don't know how I'd come back because everyone died, but.
You'd
be a zombie, of course.
Yeah, you'd be a zombie.
Yes. Okay, I could be the king of the zombies.
Yes, king of the zombies. Not just a zombie, right. The king of the zombies.
Still looking for Tina at 55.
Yes.
The one that got away.
The one that. So it's a love story.
We need to sell that.
Exactly. Return of the Living Dead 4. Tina. The love story.
We'll work on that. Actually, we're doing the show today out of a movie studio, and it's a movie studio friend of ours, who John Rusnak, who actually does horror movies. So maybe we'll get him to reprise your role somehow.
For sure. Give him a talk to him.
Dude, all I know is, I'm not going to lie, because I'll be honest, you know, I'm a huge fan of yours because I love the Return of the Living Dead films. I'm a huge zombie fan. If I saw you walk in the studio, I would probably have a heart attack. At that point in time, you know, because like everybody has a certain like iconic person they've always wanted to meet. You
yes,
know what I mean? You know, I got to talk to Michael Pare earlier. You know, now you know Tom Matthews. I would have a heart attack.
And then we get into his brains.
Yeah, first thing out of my mouth, brains.
Right.
Yeah.
So, Tom, do you do a lot of the conventions still?
You know, I've probably averaged about 4 a year. I did one over in Germany about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. That was fun. It's just, you know, it's nice to get away, take a little vacation, reconnect with all the fans and stuff. And hear their horror stories about how they came to see the Return of the Living Dead at 6 and 7 years old, which I think is bad parenting.
Yes.
And ask them why they have the tattoo of our death, of my death scene in the chapel on their calf.
Yeah, I think I'm going to have to go back and talk to my parents now, because I accidentally walked in on that movie when I was about 6 or 7 and was like, oh my God, what am I watching?
And why can I not look away?
Yeah.
Yeah. And I asked these people, I said, didn't you have, you know, nightmares? They go, oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure. For sure. For
it scarred me for life.
For weeks on end.
Now, when you were did Return of the Living Dead and Return of the Living Dead 2, you said, like, these were your favorite films. You know, did you keep any of the props or anything from the movie? And be honest, you can't lie.
You know what? I have the original T-shirts that we made up, and then I have my prosthetic from over my eyes where they threw the acid in my eyes. That came off nicely. And I've got the T-shirt, the Visage T-shirt was a clothing manufacturer. I actually was doing some modeling with them, and I liked the design of their logo, and I wore it in the show, in Return of the Living Dead, and then I invited them to come to one of the screenings, and they weren't happy. They were not happy.
Oh, funny.
So I cut off the arms and of the T-shirt, and it was my red and white jacket was over the. Said F you on the back of it. But they weren't happy.
So you cut off their shirts.
But now they might be because it's a huge success.
Yeah, it's a classic.
It's a great following. Yeah, exactly.
Well, for you, I mean, right now, you know, you're doing the dad thing and doing your own thing, you know, kind of steering away from Hollywood for a while. Do you still ever just once in a while, all of a sudden, kind of get that euphoric moment thinking about it and go, holy shit, I still can't believe I did that?
Yeah, sometimes I do.
Good. Yeah. So when you are out, because you mentioned that calf tattoo of your death scene, what is the weirdest iconic thing that a fan has done to pay homage to you?
Well, I'll tell you, some guy came over and I was signing autographs for him and stuff like that. He goes, "Oh, can you sign my arm?" And I said, "Sure." So I signed his upper arm. He was all tatted up. The guy had a lot of tattoos, and I signed my name above, actually, it was above Gene Simmons.
Oh, wow.
So then it got a little slow at my table, so I went walking around to see all the vendors and stuff, and I see this guy. He's getting my name tattooed on his arm right where I had signed it.
Wow.
So he was using your signature for a blueprint.
Yeah, I called my brother. I said, "I've arrived."
Well, at least you're above Gene Simmons.
Game over.
Game over.
Yeah, especially being above Gene Simmons. That's good placement.
Cool. Now we know that if we want Tom Matthews' autograph, we just got to find this guy and just lop his arm off.
Now, see, a good thing would be if say, "Well, now I have that arm encased in one of my rooms."
Yeah, the guy, he didn't even tell me he was going to go do it. I just happened to see him, you know, as I was walking around. It was funny.
That is funny. That's a great story, though, and actually probably made you feel really good knowing that someone thought that much of you.
So, wild.
Chance, you're getting that tattoo?
No, I will not get that. Hey, I love you, Tom, but I'm not going to get the tattoo. I might have your name on me.
Do you have any tattoos, Tom?
I don't have any tattoos.
Oh, well.
I did get my ear pierced for Return of the Living Dead, and Dan was kind of upset that I actually went out and did that.
Oh.
You know, hardcore. It's since closed up.
Yeah.
Yeah. It does that. It's weird.
Yeah. It's funny, too, because like now every kid and parent has tattoos and piercings all over them these days.
Yeah, my 16-year-old, "Hey, Dad, can I get my ears pierced?" I said, "Yeah, when you're 18.
Oh, you still know how to be a
parent. I just had a flashback of my dad.
Yeah.
Yep.
Now, was it your family life and everything that made you decide to take the break? Or was it you just kind of said, "You know what, I'm kind of burned out. Maybe take a step back for a little bit and take a break." You know, what made you take
the
break?
Yeah, you know, I got a little disillusioned with the film industry. Because the part I love about it, if you really look at a movie, you know, we did a lot of scene study and theater and stuff like that. And you get lost in the... If you're doing a theater, a play, you get lost for, you know, an hour and a half, 2 hours. You're totally into it from one scene to the other if you're in the whole production. In a movie, there's going to be one or two scenes where you actually have something to do. Because everything else is very technical, so just to move the story along. But there's actually like one or two, I mean, you can pick them up. You can watch a movie and go, "Oh, that's that's the audition scene. That's what the actors go, oh, that's the that must be the audition scene where there's actually some dialogue and there's some, you know, give and take and, you know, that book. So that being said, and in the business part of it, I was always haggling because I was always doing these low-budget stuff and the producer would call me. And it was always having to deal with the trailer and parking, and it's like it just wasn't very creative. So I just, you know, this and then I was when you're an actor, you're sitting around a lot. I mean, you can only go to the gym so many times and store so many times. Yeah. So I always like to keep busy. So I've always been doing carpentry and stuff like that. So at some point, that business kind of took off, and it was starting to cost me money to go on auditions where it didn't make sense anymore.
Okay.
And then, so that kind of took off, and I just kind of went with that, and it was more consistent, and, you know, I knew what I was doing, and when you build something, you can, like, touch it, and you can kick it, you know, you can feel it. When you do a movie, it takes a year for it to come out, and you don't really know how it's going to come out, because you don't really have control over it. The editor and the director's, adding the music to it, and you see dailies when you're on the set, you know, you can see those, you can kind of get a sense of how it looks for the last day, the couple of days before you shot it. But overall, it's kind of a very grounding experience. You can get in your head and get affected by it. You know, it's not very grounding, I guess. And whereas on the other end of it, for me, doing carpentry and construction and stuff was very, it was very creative because I had some really great clients.
Uh-huh.
A lot of people are in show business, and we'd make things. I had this one client, we cast her daughter's fist in bronze.
Wow!
And made him the front door hinges of the big door that they were using.
Oh, that's awesome!
Yeah,
wow!
And they the same client she brought down from England. They brought over some stained glass, leaded glass from an old church that was being demolished, and she brought them over to California where we were remodeling their house, and we made them into doors. We had to put glass on the outside and glass on the inside, so they're like triple glazed.
Oh, wow.
Because they're really tall, and code is anything that hits below 18 inches has to be tempered glass. So we had to sandwich the leaded glass and make doors that made walnut frames out of them. They're really beautiful.
So it wasn't just
but that whole job was very, very creative and it's always fun.
Yeah, so it wasn't just carpentry. I mean, that's like really creative, outside of the box thinking methodologies with carpentry.
Yeah, it does. It really does. And there's a lot of tricky stuff to it. It's fun.
And see, that's what's pretty awesome. I mean, you're like so well rounded. I mean, talking to you, I mean, you're, you know, this actor from iconic film, you know, so on and so forth, but you also, you're a guy's guy, you know, work with your hands-on.
Get your hands dirty.
Exactly. Yeah. You know?
So let me ask you this. You said that there's a possibility you could come out of acting retirement. What kind of project would tickle your fancy to get you to actually come back to the screen?
Well, again, it depends on the script. And like I said, it could be a comedy, but all really good comedy, in my opinion, comes out of real life situations and the events that take place, you know, and you're just like, it's so funny, and along with the writing too, and it's how it's delivered. So anything, because I'm more of a serious based kind of person. I don't really do a lot of shtick and stuff like that, or slapstick or anything like that. So I always try to keep it real, no matter what it is, no matter what the situation is. It has to be honest and real, and therefore you can be open to it. So that's the best for me.
Now, with doing like horror films, like say Friday the 13th and, you know, Return of the Living Dead, was there moments of being on set with like say the zombie, you know, stuff that you actually kind of got a little creeped out? You know, there's just a little
actually scared.
Yeah, actually scared.
Not while we were filming, but when we were doing, we were in Georgia. In Atlanta, we were doing Friday the 13th, and some 12-year-old girl came up to us and wanted to know where Jason was because she wanted him to come over that night. She was going to leave the window open so he could kill her.
Oh, my God. Holy shit.
Yeah, exactly.
Be like, he is in Europe somewhere.
Yeah. Not the standard, like, you know, yeah, I want an autograph. No, I want him to come kill me. Yeah, that's called issues with a capital ish.
Yes. Yeah, there's a little bit more going on in that girl's mind than just the normal
fan.
Yeah,
exactly. So that was kind of creepy. But also, when they shot, which was a fantastic scene, in Daly's, when Jason got a hold of the sheriff and bent him over backwards and snapped his back.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Yeah. Then just a rough cut of that, which doesn't really translate in the movie because they cut it back and forth because it was just too gruesome.
Uh-huh.
The way it was shot was unbelievable. And it doesn't, like I said, it really doesn't play in the movie or have as much of an impact as it did on me when I saw the Daly, the rough cut. It was unbelievable how they did that. And one of my favorite scenes in Return of the Living Dead Part 1 was when we get the half-corpse, the woman, and she starts talking, and the shot where the spine's going back and forth. That was just beautiful. Brian Peck was under there with Tony working the dummy,
yeah,
you know, and talking and stuff like that. It was really great. Really great scene. Really, like, a great moment. It was the first time that a zombie had talked. And we understood why they wanted the brains, because of the pain of dying. It stopped the pain of them dying. So that was kind of poignant.
Yeah, there was a lot of moments in the first Return of the Living Dead that... like that. It was kind of like, now you can relate with the zombies, and you, but at the same time, there were all these nail-biting scenes that just kind of kept you on the edge of your seat.
Right. Yeah, it just went on and on, one right after the other, just some really great gems.
Yes.
So then, okay.
What are your thoughts? Because today's show we were talking about UFOs. You haven't done any movies about UFOs, but what are your thoughts in real life about just UFOs in general and like aliens from other planets?
You know, I've never seen them, but okay. I'm not putting out the possibility that they don't exist. You know, just, I mean, Earth is such a small speck on the cosmic world. So, you know, anything's possible.
That's right.
So, and I'm sure, again, going back to the government, I'm sure they know more than they're telling.
Right. Yes. You got it.
And having worked in L.A., I mean, do you think that there's some people out there that could possibly be aliens? Because, I mean, come on.
Oh, I don't know. I don't know about that. Well, yeah, I mean, I work with them every day.
Yes, exactly.
Well, you know what? Going back, because the one thing we love to do is when we talk to our guests, we like them to talk about them. Not about, like, you know, about movies in general and the whole nine yards, but actually about them. So with that being said, you know, of course, you're a great actor. We love seeing the films. But going back to the carpentry stuff, what is your favorite thing that you have ever built and even hung on to still?
I've done so many great things. Again, only because of the clients that are available to me and the money that they have. We've got screening rooms, all kinds of stuff, pools, and I mean, just, I think the one of the unique things is the having someone's fist cast in bronze and making the front door hinges.
Yeah, that's pretty neat.
That was pretty spectacular. I mean, that particular job just went on and on with great stuff. We started that job, and they had, normally if you do a job, things will change, right? You'll get extra work. Like, we call it a change order. Mm-hmm. You have your original, you get the plans, you give them a bid, and then if anything changes, you create a change order. And usually on a regular job, there might be, I don't know, 5 to 20. On that job, there's 648.
Oh, wow.
648.
That's a lot.
So, it was a lot. So it was a very creative process, that particular gig.
So are you still doing
it? It was fun. You know, it was fun and, yeah.
Are you still doing the carpentry business?
Well, I have employees now, so I kind of oversee everything.
Okay.
Yeah. So have you ever?
I bounce around the job site to job site, making sure the guys are doing the right thing and making sure things are coming together. It's all about the details. You know, there's a lot of framing, and people don't really care about that or how you know, what the PSI on concrete is or what kind of timber it is, what kind of joints. And they don't see it. They see the finished product. So you have to know where you're going in order to get the end result. So along with the framing and the concrete and all this other stuff, you have to kind of work backwards of what we're talking about eighth and a quarter of an inches. So you kind of got to be within the mark. And then when you actually have it and things start coming together, you have to just, recalculate, make sure you're on track, and put things in the right spot, and you know the heights of things and the width of things, and also how things flow. For me, it's how things flow, making sure a door opens the right way, there's a light switch and the lights, and how it's going to affect the lighting, what kind of lighting they want. It's a whole process and other details.
Have you ever had a moment where you went to meet a client, for a future job that you were bidding on, and they didn't realize who you were until you got there, and then they saw you and was like, "Oh my God, I remember you from Return of the Living Dead or Friday the
13th." Yeah, no, I did. We finished Bryan Singer's house about a year ago. And we were up there for 2 years, and he bought the house next door to him, and we tore it down and built him a beautiful modern 7-car garage with a turntable, and it's really beautiful.
Wow!
But during that process, one of his assistants found out, that I was in acting, and Brian had hired James Cairn, who was in Return of the Living Dead with me.
Mm-hmm.
Right when he was in for a short, he was doing So they're still friends. So then that connection came, and it was really, really kind of cool. And he was, he showed me the picture. He had actually taken the time to print out something and then show it to me with Jimmy Cairn and I. Wow. And I don't really bring it up. Other people bring it up, but I'm just there to do a job and just take care of business. And I'm the same way for acting. I'm there to do a job and show up and
take care of business.
Give up my all for that. Yeah.
No, that's great. So what do people say when they find out, when they haven't known until someone tells them or something? How do they call you out on it? Do they?
Well, 15 years ago, they were like, "Oh, yeah." Now it's like, "Oh," then they have to Google you. And they go, "Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah."
Yeah.
Out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, that's kind of how the way it goes, unfortunately.
Like 15, 18 years ago, I'd be driving, and people like look at me, and they're like, "I'm not sure if I know you, or if it's somebody I know, or something." And now I don't get that anymore.
That's funny. So, what kind of movies do you personally like best? Like, if you're going to go out to see a movie, what would it be?
Well, one of my all-time favorite movies is The Godfather series. Also like Midnight Run. I could watch Midnight Run, and again, that's a comedy, but it's based on
life.
They're not going for the jokes. It's part of the movie. It works brilliantly. Mm-hmm. Everyone's great in that. My TV shows I'm watching right now, I can't wait for Ray Donovan to come out. It's going to be starting here pretty quick. And my wife and I, we waited until Breaking Bad had completely finished.
Uh-huh.
And we watched the whole series in like 3 weeks. We watched would watch like 2 or 4 a night, depending on what was going on. Yeah. And that was a lot of fun. So those kinds of shows.
And see, I'm guilty of that too. It's like with Walking Dead. I wait till the end of the season, get the box set, and then have a marathon.
That's the way to do it.
Yep.
Yeah, that's the way to do it. That's absolutely the way. So much fun.
Yeah, well, it takes away that anticipation that they always put you through whenever you have to wait like 5 months until the next season comes out.
Yeah, and then it makes an event. If you have a couple of weeks and things are slow or whatever, you're on vacation, you could sit down with somebody and watch it and take the time to do it. And Make it an event.
Yeah, so thankful for Netflix for allowing us that possibility.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Well, within all the different movies that you've worked in, who would be your favorite actor that you've worked with? Who would be your favorite for actors?
My favorite actor? Oh, man. Well, I tell you, I did a TV show with George C. Scott called Mr. President.
Yep.
And it was in his contract to leave at a certain time. So we did the scene, we did his close up, and then he left. So when they did my close up, he wasn't there.
Oh, funny!
So I had no one to work off of.
Oh, that sucks.
I was talking to a flagpole. All
right. No one stood in for you.
It was like a. There was a grip in the back saying his lines. But he was a great guy. But he was an older guy at the time, and I was in my 20s, and so that was his deal. I get it. It's just not it's not right.
Yes. Well, a lot of people don't realize.
Who said that about the O.J. Simpson, the black comedian? What was it? Chris Rock. He goes, I'm not saying what O.J. did is right, but I understand.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying what George C. Scott was right, but I understand.
You understand. Yeah, no, talking to the grip, so I guess there was no over the shoulder. We didn't see his shoulder, and that's why.
Well, I was going to say, like with Alfred Hitchcock's Psycho, a lot of people do not know that famous stab scene in the shower,
mm-hmm.
that was not him that did that part. There was actually a stand-in, and they put a black mesh over his face to take away the face, obviously, so you couldn't see that it was Norman Bates doing it, or Anthony Perkins. But it was actually a stand-in who did one of the most famous kill scenes in movie history.
Yes, yes.
It wasn't even Anthony Perkins.
Right. Someone should do a book or a documentary on just that subject alone, all the crazy stuff that actually happened.
Well, it's the movie magic, the movie magic side of it that, they cut things together and you don't realize, that nobody was actually there for certain things.
Yeah. What else?
Well, I was going to say, actually, there was something we were going to ask for a favor. We do this from all of our guests when they call our program.
Yeah, put them on the spot.
Yeah, we put him on the spot.
And we love getting this live. Segment. We love getting this live because the comedy that goes with it, we love you laughing at us.
Yep.
Yes.
And what we're going to do is ask you to do a sound bite for our show live.
Sure.
Okay. And all we need you to do is say, this is Tom Matthews, and you're listening to the Bad Boys of Paranormal at Dead X Radio.
Bad what?
Bad Boys of the Paranormal at Dead X Radio.
Bad Boys of the Paranormal. Okay.
Yep.
And what was the last part? Bad.
Dead.
Tom Matthews is listening to.
At Dead X Radio.
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you.
At Dead X Radio.
Dead X Radio?
Yes. Dead X Radio.
Yes, sir.
Right now he's writing this down going, you son of a bitch.
Yeah, I know. I hate you guys. I'm never doing this again. So whenever you're ready.
So this is Tom Matthews, Bad Boys at Dead X Radio. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
It's the Bad Boys Paranormal. Okay.
Whenever you're ready.
Okay. Hey, guys, this is Tom Matthews at Bad Boys Radio at Dead X Radio.
Perfect. Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you.
All right, guys.
That's great. Well, thank you for calling us and being on the show today.
Yeah, my pleasure. Good talking with you guys.
I appreciate it very much. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you so much for calling.
And I can't wait to see whenever you come out of acting retirement.
Dude, we got to get
him. Okay, you got it.
All right, cool. Thank you so much. Right, take it easy.
I'll talk to you guys soon.
All right, bye.
Bye-bye.
So today has been fantastic.
Yeah.
What a great guest to have on too. Like, who would have known? I had no idea that Tom Matthews did some carpentry and some
crazy,
really awesome work from what it sounds like.
Well, and that's the thing. I mean, like we were talking about earlier, that we love our guests to talk about themselves. It's not going to be just about the paranormal. You
right.
know what I mean, we do ask our paranormal questions with them, or if they're involved in horror films, so on and so forth. But we want them to talk about them, things that they like, you know, their hobbies, so on and so forth. You know, and here's, you know, Tom Matthews, you know, from, like I said, pop culture, huge hit
films. Iconic, yeah.
An iconic person that is doing carpentry work and is like a guy's guy. You know, he's that guy who's not afraid to get his hands dirty and, you know, and do the work.
That's
the
thing.
And that's awesome. I love
and I love the fact that he actually started doing it on set, because he's right. Whenever we act on in a movie, there's a lot of time where we just sit around and do nothing. So instead of like just sitting around and doing nothing and getting fat, he actually made use. Oh, did you see that?
Notice how he pointed at Patrick.
We saw the snipe.
Yes. Ta-da. So instead of sitting around getting fat, doing nothing, he's like, okay, I can only go to the gym so many times. What am I going to do? I'm going to learn a trade, because fuck this acting thing. It ain't going to last that long.
Right. Yep. And you know what? That has a lot of foresight in it, because saying, and hey, five listen. Sight. Yeah. Because, hey, listen, this isn't going to be something that may or may not last for my entire career here. So let's do something that when, let's say, the roles slow down, the offers start slowing down, that I can actually produce something for myself and actually sustain a secondary income while the career isn't really in a moving forward position, just kind of hanging out.
Well, you know what? And it's funny, too, because, like, you know, Chance and I are both actors. You know, we've been in multiple movies. The movie that we met on was filmed by this studio we are in today. John Rusnak, thank you for allotting us that. Actually, I have the trailer.
Oh, yeah.
For the movie. The trailer.
Ooh, absolutely.
For House of Blood, which is the actual movie that Chance and I met while filming.
Awesome. Yeah, we actually met on set. We were filming, I believe, it was in Clearwater at that time.
It was in Clearwater, downtown Clearwater.
Oh, cool. Yeah, downtown Clearwater. Yeah, we met our location.
Very well.
I was playing a detective in the film, and he was and Jeff was playing a police officer.
I was a police officer in the film that I get to beat someone up or something.
Yeah, he was like, you know, jerking this guy around that they arrested.
He was jerking him around, I'm sure.
Easy.
And I was in a background, an office scene. I was actually talking to a suspect, you know, that I had in my office.
Right.
It's too easy, you guys. Give
and
this
then
to
I
me.
Wound up doing some stunt work in the film. Oh, so cool. When you watch the movie,
I did some stunt work too, but it wasn't like part of the film. I just like tripped and fell on my face, and I just called it a stunt.
Yeah.
There's some scenes where you're going to be seeing SWAT guys getting killed, and a majority of those SWAT guys are actually me in different uniforms.
Over and over and over again.
Doing the stunt work, getting stabbed, shot. Yeah, I do multiple death scenes in this film.
Oh, multiple.
But, and awesome. I tell you what, honestly, I had more fun behind the scenes, like working with John, because John is freaking hilarious.
Yes, he is.
Yeah, and he is, man. He's such great. A bright, you know, guy to work with. He's smart as hell and sarcastic like us, so the humor blends perfect.
Oh, yes.
And he's, but he's also a consummate professional. You know, very, at all times.
Very cool. Much.
And, you know, you better be on your game when he gets you rolling, you know. But it really was. It was such a pleasure working with him on the film, you know, and it was a good time.
And on that note, I'm going to run the trailer.
House
run
of it. Blood all by right. John Rusnak.
We found another dead girl. I think this might be related to the Sunrise case.
What do you think? Ritualistic killer?
Joseph Martin, sent to Pine Bay Mental Hospital at age 10 for killing his mother.
Does it say how he did it?
In her sleep. Doused her with gasoline and set her on fire.
What brings you fellas way out here to nowhere?
Came here to talk to you about your son, Joseph.
I lost 35 years ago.
Are you saying Joseph Martin died 35 years ago?
Hey everybody, it's me, Mike Tyson. Well, I'm standing outside of the place the guys from DeadX Radio sent me to, and let me tell you, this place looks scary as fuck, And it's huge, too. There's even a graveyard here.
It's really not that scary, Mike. We would not send you into something that you would get hurt with.
I don't know, man. This place is pretty creepy looking.
Yeah, but you gotta go inside. You promised us you would do this.
Hmm?
Mike, if you do this for us, we will take you to Sizzler afterwards.
It's all-you-can-eat buffet night.
All right, yeah. I remember. Okay, let me grab some of this stuff. First of all, here we have the EMF.
EMF?
EMF?
Yeah, the electromagnetic dejector.
EMF?
Yeah, the EMF.
Okay, that spells EMF.
Okay, right. That works.
So let me just grab all this stuff and we'll go inside.
Now remember, Mike, this is radio, so you're going to have to describe what you see so that way the listeners can get a visual of what you're actually interacting with.
Okay, I got it. So you want me to describe everything for everybody to see so, like, they're in the room with me. Well, we're inside. Hello? Hello? Is anyone there? No? Okay, it doesn't sound like anyone's in here. But, I'm in a big round room with paintings that are all around the place. And, holy shit, they're starting to stretch. And the room is freaking moving. I'm out of here.
Mike. No, don't leave. You gotta finish this. We promised we would take you to Sizzler. When we get done with this, you have to do this. Just try to go a little bit further into the house. You don't have to go all the way. Just a little bit further for us.
Okay, a little bit further. That's it. If I get too freaked out, I'm gonna leave, though. Alright, so, there's some sort of weird train-like thing with some carts. I guess I'm gonna get on them and see where it goes.
They got a train in their house. Man, this must be a huge place. They've gotta be rich.
Wow. We need to get to know them so they can fund our show.
Absolutely. So, Mike, alright, so you're on this train and you're going right now. What are you seeing? I mean, tell us, what are you seeing right now?
Well, we went up a hill and, we're in some sort of hallway, which is really weird because the doors and the walls are all breathing. And at the end of the hallway is this floating candlestick, and it's really freaking me out.
Are you getting all this on camera?
Camera? I didn't know we had a camera.
The little square thing, it's got the light on top. It says camera on the bag.
I don't know how to read.
Okay, well don't worry about that right now. Chance, are you hearing all this stuff? I mean, I think we should go back and investigate this place ourselves. It sounds pretty intense.
Absolutely, it's freaking insane. I mean, you got doors breathing, you got freaking candles flying down the end of the hallway. This is insane.
So, talk to me, what else are you seeing?
Well, right now we just went around the corner. And it just opened up to this big, huge, like, dance floor, ballroom kind of thing. And, holy shit, there's a bunch of ghosts and they're all dancing. I'm freaking out, man.
Dancing ghosts?
You can actually see them?
They are dancing.
So wait, full apparition ghosts are dancing in front of you.
That's right, full partition ghosts are dancing in front of me.
I can't believe this. He's seen full-bodied apparitions. We have to go investigate this.
I have never personally seen a full-body apparition, and I've been dying to. On all the investigations, that's like one of the things, the key things that I've been...
Guys, there's a huge ghost sitting right next to me. I see him in the mirror. I'm out of here.
Hey, everyone. Thanks for coming to Disney's Haunted Mansion.
Holy shit, a giant mouse.
Oh, no, don't hit me. Oh.
And we are back.
Forgot to hit a button.
But we won't talk about that. We won't talk about that.
No.
All right. So I'm going to bring the phone number up again for anyone that wants to call into the show.
Please.
It's area code 727-386-9356. Right now... This is our UFO alien episode,
though
we were lucky enough to have the amazing Michael Pare on with us earlier.
Oh my God, that was awesome.
And we just got off the phone with Tom Matthews, the star of Return of the Living Dead 1 and 2.
Yes.
And that was a beautiful interview, and he was a great guy. Both guys, down to earth.
Yeah, absolutely. Awesome a lot people.
Great people. So, I mean... I'm so happy that they called in. John Rusnak, come in here.
John Rusnak,
come in. I want to introduce you.
We've
been talking about you.
Throw those headphones on.
All day. And you, sir, get up on that mic like it's your boyfriend. Whoa.
Woo,
easy now.
Yeah.
I learned that from Chance.
I bet you did. My balls are humming.
I thought you guys were on break.
We take short breaks. We're not like your film crews that take like 5-hour breaks.
It's like the bus, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
No, so this is your studio. And thank you for letting us come in
and act
like fools today. Bullshit. Are you calling
bullshit?
He's holding
bullshit? A bullshit for some odd reason.
I think he's calling us out.
Some random reason.
So, Mr. Rusnak, what is your favorite film that you've done? We just played your trailer.
Oh, cool.
Yes. Before the Mike Tyson bit, we played the House of Blood trailer.
And, of course, we hyped up that Jeff and I both were in your film.
Because we made the film.
Small parts, but, you know, we were there.
Well, they say small parts about you a lot.
I don't think exactly. I don't think my best film was. I don't think my most favorite film has happened yet. I don't really like any.
I don't like any shit I've done.
And you know what? And I got to say that too. Every time I'm on set with John, it's nonstop critique, which makes you good at your job.
That's how anyone that creates anything, art, video, whatever, you're gonna hate everything you do.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, they always say you're your own worst critic.
You know, that's actually funny that he brings it up, because every time I do the replays of the show and stuff, and I'm like, oh, God, that's fucking horrible, you know?
Yeah, it's funny, too, because every time I do the replay of the show, I look at Sean and say, that's fucking horrible, too.
Well, good. At least we're on the same page.
Yes.
Then, you know?
Yes, at least we're flowing on the same page here.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, with...
Thank you. By the way, John, thank you for giving us head.
Oh, it's not a problem. You guys were showered, so it was awesome.
Dude, it's pretty awesome. Like, I mean, how realistic that thing really actually looks.
Oh, yeah, I mean, it's cool. It's definitely cool.
Who was that?
I can't remember.
I've killed so many people, I'm not sure.
I've killed so many people
some
on
weird
screen.
Shit. I got a lot of weird shit, you know.
Dude, we got a ton of weird shit, because I tell you what. When I investigated with the old paranormal team I had, you know, Pride Paranormal, we investigated right. John's
probe.
That was Paraprobe, was the TV
probe.
Show.
Paraprobe.
He had Pride before Pride was taken by another group.
But we had Pride Paranormal, we investigated John's studio, and there was some weird shit that actually happened in that studio. And there was also some very weird props that would show up at odd moments, like when you're in the bathroom.
Oh, Chance's other video, he didn't tell you.
Yeah. Be in the bathroom. No. Be in the bathroom, and all of a sudden here comes like a cover for a porn film sliding underneath the door.
Nice.
No, that was on your infrared camera.
Dude, we really did. We had so much fun. Oh, I forgot about that.
And you know, you guys aren't really getting a view of it because of where the cameras are and at. But outside of this room here, there is a warehouse just full of props. Next door, there's a room just full of awesome stuff. And like I said, we're going to post those pictures later.
Yeah, we'll be posting
catch,
our,
but
definitely.
We'll post those pics to our Twitter pages,
and
our Facebook pages.
And our website as
which are Twitter. I mean, let's go through our Twitter again real quick. My Twitter, Jeff Hillier, which is at Jeff, JeffHillier. Follow me. Chance?
All right, mine's at Chance DXR.
No, it really is.
Chance DXR.
Mine is at Sean Rowan DXR. That is legit, absolutely.
Very legit.
And then, are you even on Twitter, John?
Do you have a Twitter, John?
No. John's like, too busy, man. Man.
He's
always
too cool for Twitter.
No, he's just...
I'm too broke for Twitter.
Broke? It's free.
I don't care if it's free. I still can't afford it.
Yeah, exactly.
If they pay me, I can't afford it.
Well, you got to think, like we were talking earlier about, like, you know, your haunted house that you set up every year. You know,
yeah, talk about that.
Yeah.
Please.
Oh, man, I've been doing haunted houses for over 20 years in Sarasota and Miami and other places, but it's getting hard out there for an operator to do a haunted house for fun, man, because the expenses are just insane. So support your local haunted house, because we're about a dying breed. We're about done. Universal and Busch Gardens have almost pushed us all out of existence. Yeah.
And the thing is, too, this is not, and I mean, trust me, I've been to them before. It's not like a little, like, you know, shindig haunted house. We're talking tens of thousands of dollars is put into this.
I was
going
to say, what'd you say? It was like how many square feet?
13,000.
13,000 square feet. I mean, that itself in itself is insane.
Exactly. It's a monster. And he has all the advanced, like, you know, I mean, animatronics, all kinds of cool stuff when you go through. I mean, it's badass. It really is.
You're fired.
You're fired.
You've been replaced.
Bullshit.
Take the bitch seat now.
The bitch seat. We got Pat in the bitch seat today.
Now, wait a minute. Now, we asked this question to, you know, the guys we're, you know, talked
yes,
to earlier,
we
Michael
did.
Pare, and we also asked this question to Tom Matthews.
Yes.
You've worked with a lot of different stars. Who is, like, one of your favorites that you remember that you had a lot of fun with on set?
Bryan Cranston just recently is freaking awesome, cool. The guy's, like, down to earth. He does, man, he's so cool. They're all cool. Some are assholes, you know how it is.
Who's the biggest asshole you've worked with?
I'm not saying it.
Right. Come on. Hey, listen. Hey, listen. He has a reputation to uphold, just as well as I have a professional license to uphold, so leave the man alone.
Well, hold on. But no one's really listening. It's just between us.
Well, there's four people online right now.
So,
All right. Well, how about this? You don't have to say who it was, but tell us the incident that made them an asshole.
There's a bunch of them. Well, there's a guy I work with. He's a big guy in town. Jeff Hillary. He's
whoa,
a prick.
Yeah, that Jeff. He's kind of an asshole.
You just went from Hillier to Hillary.
Hey, either way, hey, as long as he mentions my name somewhere, it's okay.
No, but you know, hey, Austin, another guy's awesome. John Travolta, dude, is so fucking awesome.
Travolta is a bad.
I'm gonna say you've been around Travolta too. Yeah, so.
Super friendly. I've been to his house. I shot a video. I shot something at his house.
It's just getting deeper.
Are we talking about porn again?
Yeah. You shot something at his house, all right.
But dude, I've never met a more friendly dude. I mean, the guy, he lets you in his house. He takes care of everybody. And
that's bullshit. When they found me in the closet, he made me
true.
Leave.
That's true. You were taken. But nah, man, the dude is so sickly real. It's retarded. He's such a caring guy. But
he definitely is.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's, you know, God, there's so many people. Naomi Watts is really awesome. She's a sweetheart, really sweet lady, and always looks out for the crew. Like most people don't look out for the crew. You know, they're like, hey, fuck the crew. You know, let's get the shots.
Treat you like servants. Right. Yeah,
it's like when you make when you watch the making of Jaws, and there's a scene there where Steven Spielberg was saying when one of the boats was sinking during filming, and everybody was like, you know, get the actors, and you hear him yell, "Fuck you, get the cameras."
Yeah. It's rough. Well, you know, the guys, you know, the actors are professional. A lot of these guys, like, you know, like I work with Matt Dillon and a couple other guys, and those guys have been like on film since they were born. I mean, these guys, they don't know the real world. I mean,
yeah,
it's
true.
Like,
right.
We were working on this movie called Sunlight Junior, and Matt Dillon was at that time never ever set foot in a Walmart.
Wow.
Really?
Yeah, he never set foot in a Walmart. So the producer and directors, and they took him to Walmart so he could, because the movie's about a poor guy and he was living on the streets, and he had like he has a wheelchair and stuff, and he was like blown away by Walmart. I mean, just imagine you're so closed up all the time, and you're driven everywhere, and everyone's always after you. You're like, hey, let me sign you.
Yep.
Sign my leg.
Sign my upper arm so I can go get a tattoo of it.
Tom Matthews from Return of the Living Dead just told us a story about this signing of his arm.
Dude, it's
getting
nuts.
It tattooed.
When we did Spring Breakers in Tampa at St. Pete, people would wait for hours just to see Selena Gomez and paparazzi. And
you were telling us
that there was something Selena Gomez gave you. No, it was Vanessa Hutchinson that gave you something. What was
the poster?
The poster for Sucker Punch.
Oh yeah, that's Sucker Punch. Yep. Sucker Punch. Yeah, Vanessa Hutchinson. She was really, all those chicks were cool. Harmony Korine, the director, he was cool. The Spring Breakers was all cool. It was a hell of a job, man. It was sweaty and hot and shitty. And we were covered in beer all because the movie's all about beer, sex, and dope.
Yeah,
people party, and so that's all we did was just.
Yeah, I tell you what, I watched about 15 minutes of that movie. I couldn't stomach the rest.
It's an autobiography. It's an autobiography of Pat.
I kept watching just because I was hoping for the nude scenes.
Yeah, I couldn't stomach. Couple, I couldn't stomach it.
Much, I mean, there's more nude scenes behind the scenes than there was that were shot because you only put so much in the movie. So
right.
You're gonna show everyone's all naked. I mean, the actors are standing there buck naked, just like in the House of Blood.
Yeah.
Tiffany, you know Tiffany.
Yep, I know Tiffany.
She was she was a grip in the movie, and we didn't have anyone play the part. So I'm like, "Will you be naked?" And she's like, "Yeah, I'll be naked." I
said, "Fantastic."
I was like, "Will you let this guy carry you? Well, he kills you, and then can he carry you around?" And she's like, "Sure." And then there's actually a clip behind the scenes of she's there naked, and I go, "We need to move a light." She runs over buck naked, grabs a light, moves the light, runs back over. And
dude, that is a diehard professional right there, buddy.
So, John, why did you not ask me to get naked in the movie?
We did. But
you know what?
How do you think I got
the
nickname
ratings?
Puppet Pants?
Puppet Pants.
The ratings on that movie would have went the opposite way of where they were trying to go if you had.
What are you trying to say?
I'm trying to say they wanted their movie to be successful.
Whatever.
It's like that Bush. Or what was that? The Hangover.
Wait, what?
No.
Derek and Mushroom.
Great Bush.
Dude, all of a sudden, everybody just flipped to that Rolodex of memory and paused.
Yes.
He had to grasp it.
And I thought I heard like a scream come out of all of our heads.
No!
That was like when we were in the store that one day. All of us, you know, unfortunately, we really do hang out together off the show as well.
Yes,
we're around each other all the time.
Unfortunately.
And, yeah. Unfortunately for the people around us.
Right.
You know, and we do. We have no filter. You know, we were walking through the store and we were buying some stuff, and this woman said something about Bush beer.
Oh,
and
my
she
God.
Goes, yes, she's like, I like drinking Bush. And I was like, I don't mind eating it. You know, and everybody in the store was like,
Or
except for
was,
us.
Where was the one? Yeah. Was the we were? Yeah, we were at a fabric store. We were at a fabric store, and we were actually getting a some fabric cut table for a table to cover a table up.
Yes.
And as we're walking away, this woman goes, "I think I need 13 inches." We're like, "I think we can accommodate you."
All together,
we can make that 13 inches.
And the worst part is, as we're walking away, I was like, "I think every woman thinks that." Yes. And the two old ladies next to me were smiling and nodding.
We got a lot of old ladies' phone numbers that day.
It was kind of
not really sure if they're correlated.
Yeah, there might be some kind of connection there. I'm not sure. Yeah. It's probably paranormal.
Connection.
Probably
synchronicity.
Synchronicity.
All that's right.
Michael Paré said the word synchronicity.
All right, is that a real word?
Yes.
Yes.
For our listening audience, for our listening audience out there, you have to understand that when we first were developing the idea for doing this show and
last week,
sitting on the toilet. But when we were coming up with the when everybody was developing the ideas and putting everything in on how we do the show and the whole nine yards.
It's with the meth.
Yes, with the meth. You know,
crystal meth.
Yeah, we were doing meth and drinking.
Disclaimer, I do not do crystal meth. I have a professional license to uphold.
Oh, yeah, Sean has a professional license to uphold, and Chance and I have a professional reputation to keep down.
There we go. Exactly. So you are going to be my PR guy in the future, just so you know. But long story short, Patrick's favorite word is synchronicity. Everything that we've done comes together is because of synchronicity. And then sure as shit, we had Michael Paré on the show earlier segment, and Michael Paré said, it's synchronicity. And we all were just dying laughing.
And we didn't want to laugh too much because he didn't know.
Exactly. Right. He's not on the inside loop of the joke. And in the back of his mind, he's like, "What's wrong with these assholes?"
I know. He's like, "These guys are weird. I said a word."
Yeah.
But yeah, it's right. I mean, synchronicity kind of happens and make everything that we've put together has been that synchronous vibe that every time we turn around, we're like,
John's calling bullshit.
Yeah, I'm just giving fluff. I'm trying to fill time.
Synchronicity.
Okay, well, you know what? Going back to our extra guest here today for John Rusnak.
We've had three famous guests on the show today.
All in one shot.
Yeah. All in one shot.
I'm fucking real famous.
I love it. All right, you need to come on the show more often.
Now John likes to talk, in more of the positive light about different people he's talked with or worked with. So who is like somebody who is, say, a comedian in films that just cracked you up in real life?
Me.
Yeah, this guy. Oh, fuck, man.
He said comedian.
Funny. He's funny. Dude, fucking Bryan Cranston's funny as shit, dude.
Really?
Really?
Yeah. He's fucking funny, dude. We were doing a scene where we were taping up a wire on his belly. And we were like taping him. He's like, going, like it was a big dog. He's fucking hilarious, dude. He's fucking sick, man. The guy's funny.
Nice.
Dude.
Right now, there's people around the world or around,
there's
well, wherever.
Yeah. There's three people.
There's three people listening to this program right now going, "Bryan Cranston." They got the whole image of Bryan Cranston swinging a big dong around.
He's fucking awesome. I told him that.
If anyone I know is listening, they're probably going, "Who's Bryan Cranston?"
Well, that's because you hang out with 18 to 22
years. Shut up.
Hey, is that guy that plays the piano?
Fuck,
I'll go play the piano all fucking day.
To become famous, remember, all you have to do is be homeless and learn how to play the piano.
That's it. You can have bills, you can abandon your family, but if you can play the piano, all forgiven.
All forgiven.
All forgiven. All right, we are actually running out of time. We need to get to legit or bullshit.
Hey, so, thanks, John. Appreciate it.
Thank you. John.
Thank you.
I'll see you guys later.
All right.
Are you going to lock us in again?
Yeah, he'll actually be seeing us in here in 30 minutes when we get off air.
Yeah.
All right.
All right, so now I think we're going into our next issue.
Like today's show has been an issue in itself.
Jeff
the finger there for.
It's time for legit or bullshit. Okay. You guys just didn't know when to shut up.
Okay.
It's okay.
Legit or bullshit.
Legit or bullshit. Right, okay. So, Mr. Sean Rowan, who is our host of Legit or Bullshit, why don't you tell us the story?
Today, the story is the five alien species that are currently in contact with Earth right now. So, everybody, take a moment. You should have already processed this, but however, take a moment. Decide which one of your cards that you're going to use to hold up to the main camera.
Which one of our cards?
Whatever. But so on the count of three, we're going to hold up the card and figure out what we're going to call it. So one.
Hold on. We're not ready yet.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, everybody.
That camera up there. We're all going to count of three. I think I just gave mine away.
Yeah, you probably did.
It's like a secret. All right. On the count of three. Ready, everyone? One, two, three.
Ooh, two and two.
Two and two.
Let the showdown
that actually
begin.
Has that actually is a change from our previous shows, because usually it's been like three and one, or whatever.
It's always been 3-1.
Oh, actually, I want to go to Patrick first, because he held up legit as well as Chance did. But I want to go to Patrick first and find out why he thinks that this is legit.
Okay. Well, I mean, as far as alien races on planet Earth, I find that legitimate because I do work with you assholes on this show, and I think every one of you is a fucking alien.
I really can't argue that point.
Yeah. So, I mean, if I had to say that there's aliens among us, ta-da!
I'll take that.
But other than that, though, I really do. I've actually read other articles. I mean, I know this is about this article, but
yeah, that's
I've
right.
actually Let's read other articles.
Nope, you're not. You are not allowed to use other articles. That's the rules of legit or bullshit.
The rules.
It's only this article. You are not this allowed to use only. Any other articles.
Well, this article, there are five.
Correct. That's what it's saying.
So yes.
Okay, and
I don't like the article's necessarily description of the aliens.
Right. So let's
let me
say,
see if I can get some of these on screen here.
Actually, we have a picture of the first one is called the Esesani. I guess that's how you would say
is
it.
Mm-hmm.
So that, okay. that you know,
and you
have
found
have
a
you,
picture of an Esesani?
We did actually.
Oh, okay.
It was actually embedded in the article.
There's a picture.
You know, it's not exactly 100% like a picture. But it's a. It's a artist rendering of what they based on the description of what that type
I'm
of
I'm seeing
alien
it now for
would,
the first time.
Right. And you know right now there are Sasani, you know, they're on this planet going, he fucked
right.
it up.
See,
it's called Sani.
I know, right?
See, these are the different aliens, and I believe that first one, this one right there, that pops up is the Esesani.
Okay.
So
those are all of the ones they were describing.
These are the five different races that they described in the article right here.
But an artist rendering.
Right. These are all artist rendering because...
I like the blog.
We don't have any real pictures.
Right,
yet,
exactly. So you believe this is legit based off of what?
Well, I believe it's legit because, again, I'm going to go on air once again and say that I have no problem with us not being the only ones in the universe. And as far as if we believe in aliens and UFOs, what today's show's about, the fact of the matter that they're already here... Well, yeah, I have no problem believing that. I don't necessarily say that those are the five. You know, you guys won't let me elaborate on it today, but...
Well, it's just based off of this article.
We can elaborate after legit bullshit, but...
Well, here, you're obviously struggling and drowning.
I'm not
struggling and drowning.
Yes, you are. I'm not struggling and
Okay, Chance, Patrick's...
Chance, so Patrick's, legit.
Okay, hold on. I call... Patrick's legit bullshit. So I want to hear Chance's version of legit.
My reasoning behind this is because the fact that I think that whoever wrote this actual article, you know, actually truly believes this. They had done a lot of research, it seems like, a lot of homework on this to say that, yes, this is what we have got so far. Because like we said, we're basing legit or bullshit on the article alone. We're not
Correct.
Basing it on outside sources or
Correct.
Anything else. So I think this article alone, yes, is legit. I think because they believe it's legit. I think whoever their sources was, they got this information, you know, from, obviously did their homework because there's a lot of detailed information into it that kind of says that, yeah, they really believe this is true. So I'm saying this article is
I agree.
Legit. Do I
believe? So basically you're saying you believe that the article was written. So that's why you think
no,
it's legit.
That is not what he
actually
said.
I mean, that's like not really a basis on anything. Okay, the article's legit because I do believe someone actually wrote it.
No, and believe what
and
they
believe
wrote
what
is
they
exactly
wrote.
What he was saying.
If anyone else would like to chime in on this, call the number on the screen, 727-386-9356.
Is a fucking alien.
I'm saying...
I'm trying to protect my alien race.
I know.
I'm saying that they got a lot of detailed information that says that somebody out there has been doing their homework and has maybe been a part of this.
Right.
That's what I'm going
okay.
with.
Okay. Okay. I want to hear.
Yeah, let's all look at
Jeff's opinion.
My opinion. I mean,
we know it's bullshit, but like, why do you believe it?
Why
his
do
opinion
I think it's
bullshit?
Bullshit? Okay, all right. Here's my reason for thinking that it's bullshit. I think that there is alien activity. I think that the races that they're saying exist now, right now. I'm not convinced
then that
that
would be legitimate.
Huh?
That would be legit then.
If you don't understand that. The rules of the game.
Wait, I believe the rules of the game. Let him finish because I'm sure he's going to tie it all in.
Because, I hope so.
No, because here's based on this article. This article, I think, goes too far into the extreme of just trying to tap in on the whole wow factor of it. And it's like that difference between science fiction and science. Science is actually going to study the reality of something and what we can prove and what actually makes sense based on our current surroundings and everything. I think this article kind of goes more into the ether of just fantasy. Ooh, okay. And it really comes across to me, and the reason I think it's bullshit is because it's too extreme.
So let me ask you this.
No, you're not allowed to ask me.
No, way. All right, what are you going to ask me? Okay, so you're actually going because of the description of the aliens is why you think it's bullshit.
Well, right? I mean, I'm not basing it on the caricature drawings that
No, not the caricature drawings, but I'm just saying because you're saying it's going into the ether, so you believe.
I think that
I had a problem with the description too, so I was on the fence with legit or bullshit.
Yeah.
So you took the bullshit route where I took the legit route.
Exactly.
Okay.
Because if there are aliens here on the planet, then I think that I think that I'm not convinced that they're blended in with society. That's my problem. And the reason being is because if this has been happening for all these years, then effectively you're going to end up with people that are out in society as kids that have to kind of blend in with other kids too. And if they have any kind of childhood or John experiences Rowan. And things like that. I mean, kids,
how do you not know?
You know how kids are. They say the darndest things. No, they're fucking, they're open. They just say whatever the fuck's on their mind. True. And so you're going to get some kid to be like, hey, buddy, guess what? I'm actually an alien. I'm not from this planet.
Right. I think some kids say that. I mean, right, because I think Sean is a reptilian shapeshifter.
Shitter? Are you a shape shitter?
I'm a shape shitter.
I can shit multiple. I can shit multiple shapes.
So what you're saying is you're the human Play-Doh fun factory.
Yes, absolutely.
Just pull his arm and it shoots
star,
out.
Star, triangle, fucking rectangle, star, yeah, whatever. Rectangle. Okay. Well, I'm going to go kind of along the lines of Jeff. I don't know how closely correlated it will be, but my problem... My issue with it is, number one, how did you come up with the race names? Unless you actually specifically spoke to that alien and said, hey, what race are you? I'm a Yahanel, I'm an Arcturian, I'm a fucking this, okay. I'm a that.
I'm a Hancock.
Okay, yeah, you know, or I'm an I'm a Nessasani or whatever. Okay, great. You've speculated on the names, number one, because obviously you haven't spoken to these aliens to say, oh, I'm an Arcturian. Okay, number two, like Jeff said, you're going to have to be blended into society in order for these races, unless they're a single entity being placed down as, like, let's say an ambassador. Like, okay, you're going to be the ambassador for the Esasani race or the Arcturian or the Yahanel or whatever, however the hell you pronounce
however
it.
However the hell you pronounce it.
You know, and so where are they going to be? You know, are they going to be layered up in the secret Dulce base that we had spoken about?
But you know, we can't talk about it.
Right.
It's not article related.
But no, I'm just saying, like, where would they be? Because they're not going to be living in America.
Why not public?
Why though? Not? Because yeah. They're not going to be like everybody else. They're going to have those weird kinks. They're going to have those weird
I've
quirks.
I've seen some weird
people,
fucking people, though,
there
Sean.
There are some weird people, but... At the end of the day, when I prick them with a fucking needle and I take their blood, their DNA is going to come back as human.
Okay.
If I prick them and they start bleeding green, you know, something's up. Now,
okay, well,
are we going to say that they bleed green? No. But my whole thing is, like I said, my whole basis off of this thing is, A, you've come up with the description name of this race. How do you know? Because you haven't spoken to them. That's my two cents.
Okay. Actually, I'm kind of a fan of the the Arcturians, just because I love Men in Black.
Right.
So I would love for the Arcturians
right.
to really
you.
Be real.
You know what? Thank you, yeah, okay. Because the Arcturians came straight out of a fucking movie.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. So wait, now I have a question. Just
and that has never been
okay,
spoken
well,
of before.
Wait. Never. Okay. So if you could pick what alien race we could all be, what alien race would you be, Chance?
Oh God.
You'd be a fucking gray.
Do they have power? I'd probably
be a gray. Yeah, I'd probably be a gray because they seem to have like mental telepathy and stuff too. You always hear in
right.
all the stories.
Because they
yeah.
don't speak to you, but
and
yet somehow you hear
yeah,
that.
I'd want yeah. that extra
yeah, the anal probing.
The anal probing.
I do that without
I would probably be a Nordic.
A Nordic,
yeah.
Okay.
Oh, a goddess.
Yes.
God, get it right, motherfucker. Jeff?
I would want to be the reptilian just because the shape-shifting thing, I think that's kind of cool. Because, you know, I mean, I'm a fan of,
who's like Mystique and X-Men. Mystique,
yeah. To where I can just, like, look like anybody, but if I can, like, sound like them too, I mean, you know, you imagine the trouble I could get into.
Oh, my God. If I could do that, I swear, man, I kid you not, because, I mean, we know my man crush is Hugh Jackman. I would be Hugh Jackman.
Notice how the name has Jack in it.
Do you see this keeps coming out?
I would be Hugh Jackman for like 24 hours at least.
Yes.
And, dude, I would find a reason to pour shit on my shirt in front of women to take my shirt off. I would be like, oh, damn, there goes my coffee. Oh, another shirt, you know?
Yeah, actually, you know, you bring up a very good point. Shit. If you're a shapeshifter, do you have to go to the gym, or do you just get the body like... You know?
Good point. Oh, actually, you know what?
Can you redo that noise, please?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, just making sure.
That's how his body does. Right.
Let's go with that. Let's roll with that. Jeff gets a hard on. You are now a reptilian. You can shapeshift, be whoever you want to be. Who would you want to be for 24 hours, Sean?
Who would I want to be for 24 fucking hours?
Yeah, that's actually hard.
Woo, that's a good question, because I've actually never contemplated this before. Probably somewhere along the lines of, who is the... Bradley Cooper.
Okay, good call. Yep.
Okay. Who would I be?
Oh, Patrick.
Jesus
Christ. Preferably somebody 30 pounds lighter.
Yeah. probably 50 pounds lighter. I don't know. I'd want to try the other side. Maybe like Marilyn Monroe or something.
So you could get fucked.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Why not? Excellent.
He likes that.
No, actually,
it'd be kind of cool because you could pretend you're a zombie and freak the fuck out of a lot of people.
Yeah.
I think it's just because he likes the idea of a penis coming at him.
No.
And on that note, okay. Wow.
Yeah, he wants to be Hugh Jackman. I want the penis fetish.
Well, I want to be Wait. I want to be Hugh Jackman and have women chasing me around.
Right.
Let's be real.
Exactly.
No, I'm just saying, if you could be anybody or whatever.
Tyndall, would you be? Hey, Tyndall, back here, man. He was saying George Clooney. Another good call.
Oh, George Clooney, okay. I could see.
Okay, Jeff.
Yeah.
You know what? You know what I would do? I think that I would become President Obama.
Why is that?
Oh, God.
No, just because I would love to just go in and fuck with people. And like, you know, just like go. No, seriously. It's like, imagine like, you know, going to like a mall and like, you know, just walking up to people and being like, I'm fucking things up on purpose. Just to like get everyone talking.
Oh, my God.
Right,
dude, can you imagine how bad you could screw with Secret Service?
Oh, yeah.
Dude,
you turn around, you're Obama. Just pretend you're President Obama. And you're like, I'm going to go to the bathroom. You walk in there, come out as Jeff. And they're like, what the fuck? And you go back in real quick and slam the door. They jerk it open. And then here's President Obama again.
Oh, my God. That would be awesome.
Actually, dude, that guy's going to be vacation. You know
what? We're all really retarded because I actually did figure out who I would be if I was shaped.
Okay, who?
Okay.
Okay.
The one that we've all missed, Hugh Hefner.
Yeah, I want to be an 80-year-old, you know.
Erectile dysfunctioning. Fucking.
I mean, granted.
Viagra. I mean, it doesn't matter.
If I'm Hugh Jackman, trust me, they'll give me a key to the Playboy Mansion.
All right. Yeah, but I would own the Playboy Mansion with all of them.
All right, you know what? It is time for the X List, and you guys need to not talk over the intro this time.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay?
Okay.
So yes. All right. So yes.
Nice guys.
So, yeah. Nice guys.
Exactly.
So for our X List for this week is the top 10 reasons you think you may have been abducted by aliens.
Interesting.
All right. So number 10, when you sneeze, the channel or the TV changes channels.
All right.
Number 9, you only mow in circles.
Crop circles. That's another great subject.
Yes.
Number 8, you think Ancient Aliens is a documentary of your family history.
Yes.
Number 7, you can read crop circles.
Ooh.
Actually, like Braille.
Like, yeah, it's they do Braille, say yeah. things. What are the messages that they're saying, though? What do you think?
Go to Land the Playboy Mansion.
I think it's a warning to everybody else. It's like giant warning labels on Earth. It's like, no, don't go here.
Don't go here. Okay. It's telling it, stay away, stay
this
away.
This is Winslow, Arizona. Stay away.
Winslow, Arizona. Jeez.
I promise you, we landed there and the place sucks. All right, just keep going.
All right.
Number six, cattle mutilations seem normal to you.
That's where I get my steak from.
Right. Number five. Bright lights makes your asshole hurt.
Oh! Ay,
number four, when E.T. phones home, he calls your house.
Nice.
Number three, sleeping on steel tables becomes comfortable to you.
That's good. I like that.
Number two, you set off metal detectors without ever having surgery.
Be like, I'm 6 years old. Why am I setting this off?
And number one.
Number one.
You refer to Kanye West as your leader.
No anal probing in that whole goddamn thing. What is wrong with us?
You know, there was implications.
There was implications.
I just got texted that he was, this person, Aaron, was surprised that no one said Kate Upton for the boob factor. So shout out to you, Aaron. Thank you for that.
See, I would rather awesome be the, I would rather be the guy that gets Kate Upton if I'm going to shapeshift into something.
Dude,
yeah, but you'd still have to shapeshift.
Somebody was thinking along my lines.
She does have an awesome set of.
See, I'm just
eyes.
Telling you.
Yes.
Imagine what I could have done as
those
a woman.
Those are known as personal flotation devices.
Definitely. So. Our X list, thank you. Good job, Chance.
Yes,
thank
you, absolutely.
Thank you. Yeah, it's about the same time you did.
So,
real quickly, I just want—I'm sorry, to interrupt, Sean. Just real quickly before I forget, because we know my ADD. Giving a shout out to Paul Wilson. He actually had messaged me and said, "Great, good luck on the show today." So, shout out to Paul Wilson. So.
Awesome.
That's awesome. Thanks, Paul.
So, since we're on aliens, does anyone want to get into the Dulce base?
I was on your mom last night.
Yeah, I know. Because that supposedly houses some of these quote-unquote aliens that are in contact with Earth right now.
Okay, now my question is, when you say get onto Dulce Base, do you mean we're doing something we should not be talking about on air?
Get into the topic.
Or do you mean the topic?
Just get into the topic of the Dulce Base.
It depends.
And once again, FBI is following around DXR.
Yes!
Go ahead, follow me. Follow me, please.
You're going to be awfully bored, trust me.
Trust.
So, let's say go for it. Let's go for Dulce Base.
Yeah, so Pat was the one who actually introduced me to the topic of the Dulce Base, because I had actually never heard of it before, so maybe that gives some validity to the fact that it's like a hidden base.
Validity. I mean, what I know about it is from stuff I've watched, of course. Can't believe everything you see, but, I mean, it is interesting that there is a secret base. And they say as far as the levels go down or whatever is the different experimentation and who works on that level.
Right.
And supposedly on level 7 is where the dastardly deeds.
Right, like all the sinister. Come in.
Dastardly deeds done dirt cheap?
Done dirt cheap. Right. Because I never have a clause high society.
No. We're not going there. But now, do you believe that there could be... now, let's say that there is a secret base, Dulce, that has been built... or numerous secret bases that have been built. How many people are involved in that project? And how easy is it to keep that many people quiet?
Well, from what I understand, I don't even know why.
Somebody texted Jeff and was like, hey, can you do a sexy dance?
Yeah.
And this is what he came up with.
It was my happy dance. You did your happy dance earlier. I'm doing mine now.
Oh, well, okay. What? It's not a fucking pants off, dance off. So
that'll be later tonight at Jeff's house with those two.
You know what's so funny, though? We like to share some of the behind the scenes.
Behind the scenes.
No, we don't. You guys just called me out, so fuck you.
No. I was going to say, just real quickly, it was funny because earlier we had all stepped out to take care of something, and we come walking back in. This is before the show, obviously. And all of a sudden we walk in and here's Sean and Jeff both sitting around shirtless.
Let's just clarify that it was fucking hot as balls.
Hot as hell in the studio. So
it still is hot as balls in here. I've been sweating this whole time.
Okay. It was one of those moments.
It was hysterical. I don't give a damn what you say.
I so badly just wanted to take a picture what's going on.
I think someone did get a picture and threatened to upload
it. I just want to clarify that I fucking hate you right now.
Yeah, that's a dirty shit. I think that's the dirty deeds that are going on level 7 at the Dolce.
But speaking of the Dulce bit, how many people would be involved in that project?
Well, I mean, from what I understand, well, actually, there was a whistleblower. That's why we know about the Dulce.
Right,
base.
But that's what I'm saying. One person, though. Well, one person.
I think
everyone else
more,
is kind of. You know?
Well, that's because.
Well, you know what? Here's the thing. Realistically, any government cover-up. All right, as far as it goes for anything alien, the asteroid coming, so on and so forth, they're never, ever, ever going to admit it.
Mm-hmm.
Because at that moment, okay, they know we had, at that moment, they'll know they'll lose their integrity from everybody.
Right.
So no matter what, I guarantee if there's a species that's dealing with us right now, an alien race, and the whole entire U.S. government knows about it, the whole nine yards, they're never going to admit it. Now, however, if it comes to light later, they'll say they just got here.
So, I have a different theory on that. I have the opposite theory on that because I think the government actually are the ones that put out these conspiracy theories about aliens because the government's going, you know what? We don't want the masses to know the real stupid shit we're doing.
Absolutely.
So let's let them freak out about fucking aliens.
Conditioning and dissemination.
Not only that, but I think that kind of ties back into what we were talking about before when saying, okay, there's this massive meteorite or whatever that's going to hit the planet. Let's just fucking lay it all out on the table because what do we got to hide now? Because we're all about to be decimated. So do you think they finally cough up and say, okay, listen, Area 51 exists. We have done experimentation. Dulce fucking exists. That there was a guy down there that went down in a basket and got blasted by fucking lasers. And he's missing half of his
fingers.
Hey,
we have a caller.
Oh, yeah,
we have a caller. Say bye to
them. We have a caller. All right. Caller, you are on the air with Dead X Radio Live. Who are we speaking to? Hello?
Hello?
Don't tell me your wrong number. Hello.
Hey.
You're live on the air with Dead X Radio. How are you doing?
Hey, it's Mike.
Mike, how you doing?
What can we do for you?
Hey, it's Mike Flynn.
Okay. What's going on, Mike?
Mike Flynn, how you doing, sir?
Hey, your Dulce base, Pat, your seventh floor is cryogenic storage.
Okay.
Fifth floor is your alien housing.
Somebody who's read
your
stuff.
Your crazy stuff is on your fourth floor. It's mind control experiments.
Okay.
Just get you your information. It was supposedly leaked by security personnel.
Right, right. Somebody had their hand incinerated, from what I understand. The person who did.
Well, it was the security personnel that supposedly leaked the information.
Right. Unfortunately, I wasn't prepared and know the name of that person that did leak that and was the whistleblower, but I have watched.
I guess he was supposedly dying. He worked there. He was diagnosed with cancer. So as he was passing away, he leaked the information on his deathbed. Thomas Castillo was the guy's name.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. Very good. So what do you think about this, Mike? I mean, do you think this has any kind of truth to it, or... Do you think it's a...
Hey, I told you earlier today, I've been doing a lot of search on all this stuff. So, I don't know. You know, there's no way to look into it since the guy was dying.
That's
you know,
true.
It's 1996 when he's leaking the information, when he's dying of cancer. It supposedly happened in the 70s, and we're just now learning about it.
Okay.
The Freedom of Information Act didn't give us anything. They blacked everything out and they burned everything out. So just like Jeff said earlier, they're not going to, anything with any merit, they're going to cover it up. They're not going to tell us.
No, I true. But now, again, everybody has
it's going to destroy religion as we know it. So
yeah,
the way to control the populace is through religion. So if they release that there is aliens, how is that going to affect Christianity and Catholics?
Right. You got it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you're going to have mass hysteria.
Muslims are going to go nuts. They're already having problems with that as it is. So they're not going to give that up easily.
Okay, well, Mike, we asked this question on air earlier, you know, to ourselves. I'm going to ask you, if the government came out and said, we have an impending alien attack coming, we have a fallout plan for what we need you guys to do, would you follow the government's rule and what they're wanting us to do, or would you strike out on your own and hope for the best?
Hell no. Pat will tell you, I already got my evacuation plan.
titty bars don't count, Mike.
Be like a Shaun of the Dead with his right. Of the bar.
That's why That's why I moved to Georgia. I'm already ahead of the plan.
Nice.
Okay, but you're still not answering the question, though, Mike. You didn't say, is there any merit to this Dolce base, or don't you feel there is? I mean, which one, where do you side? I think as long as every...
You can't ask someone a question.
Wait a second. I'm interrupting the caller.
Yeah, you are.
God forbid I'm on a show. All right, so anyway.
I think the base is... You know, I think Area 51 was a smokescreen. I think they gave us Area 51 to cover up other bases.
Yeah.
Okay.
And this could be possibly one of them.
Right. Okay. So they got us all looking at Area 51. Oh, there's the alien base. Let's all go look at Area 51.
Right.
Meanwhile, you know, they've got the Dulce base right there. Yeah. Not too far away.
No, not too far
but
away. Exactly.
Close enough to where they got us distracted.
And see, right. that's just what Mike, we were saying earlier.
Well, but my big question for Mike is, do you think Patrick is an alien?
Patrick is an alien.
Possibly. I mean,
yeah, I'm a sextillion.
You know what Jeff was saying earlier, I don't technically think, you know, kids, you know, I've got the young kids, so of course, you know, Jeff helped me expose. Remember all those years ago I had the Razor phone, and Jeff helped me expose my daughter with the ghost up in the bedroom and the Razor phone. He helped expose that picture.
Definitely.
Right. Okay, so I've got the younger kids now, and I agree with what Jeff said earlier. Kids will say whatever that comes to mind. However, being looking into the sleep and the whole Force Kind movie where the scientist or the psychologist exposed the dreams and all that stuff, I think they might be able to repress all those waking moments so far deep into us. It can cause PTSD issues to where people don't know that they ever even experience those situations.
Definitely.
Yeah, so
definitely.
Being real, the human mind is fragile. It can only take and handle so much, you know, especially information. And with that being said, I mean, let's say that, like, he's correct. Let's say they're repressing these memories that you don't remember being abducted or anything else. Could that possibly explain some mental snaps that have happened around the world where people have, like, gone off on a shooting spree or, you know, just, you know, killed themselves for no apparent reason, so on and so forth? Could that be something that could have led into that?
Can you say that again? You were kind of garbled.
Oh, I was saying that with that being said about the repressed memories, do you think that some of the people who have snapped, per se, around the world, who have gone on shooting sprees and, you know, or killed themselves for no apparent reason, do you think that maybe they could have been abducted, had their memories repressed, and that is actually what made them snap, hence why nobody could explain why they did what they did, they just snapped?
Yeah, go and watch a movie. It's called Nightmares. I watch Solar movies. It lets you watch movies for free. It's a documentary on people that suffer from sleep paralysis.
Okay. Okay.
It's a fairly new diagnosis.
Mm-hmm.
Well, actually, people are living out their nightmares while they're awake.
Yeah.
They don't know if it's UFO abduction or paranormal, or if it's just some kind of new illness that they're suffering. But what if it is alien abduction that they're actually PTSD reoccurrence?
Okay, yeah. I could definitely see that.
And that's causing them to actually snap. Just throwing shit against the wall for you guys to think about.
Yeah, you know, it's all speculation at this point. I mean, I think with the topics that you brought up and the points that you've made, I'm going to agree with you because I'm just going to say thank you for agreeing with me a lot.
Oh, Jesus. Good God. That's why I don't like the show sometimes.
Oh, shut up. All right, Michael, thank you for calling in. I appreciate your viewpoint on this. And next week, our topic next week, I want you to come in because you actually make sense. Anyone that agrees with me makes sense.
Well, and also, too, our guest next week is Bill Bean.
You guys
Bean.
Have a good day.
You too. Yeah, thank you.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up. Bill Bean.
Yes, Bill Bean, who he's doing a Lifetime series. You know, he's been on Discovery. You name pretty much the network he's been on there for something. Bill Bean is our guest next coming weekend.
Awesome.
Yep, he's going to be an awesome guest. Cannot wait to talk to him.
Aaron, the guy who said about Kate Upton and the Boob Factor earlier. About
yeah, thanks, Aaron.
Patrick equals starfish. Stars equal aliens. Therefore, Patrick is an alien. Whoa.
Yes. And so, he's absolutely right.
Great thank you, Aaron. Correlation. That's, there.
Wait. 6 degrees of alien.
I told you.
That's just what I was going to say. That's weird. You. We had the telepathy going.
Synchronicity.
Synchronicity.
It's the underwear thing in the.
We found another excuse for synchronicity.
But so yeah. That was awesome that he called in and actually clarified what bases and what levels had what.
Yes. I do agree with that, actually.
That was awesome. So
yeah, because now we know Pat doesn't have any real information on anything.
No, Pat was close. He was on base. He just, you know.
I think what actually happened just then clarified. Is you called Pat out on something he wasn't ready for.
No, I just didn't know the person's name who was the whistleblower. But I mean, I do know the information about the base. Right. I mean, know there's seven levels, asshole.
If you go on YouTube, you can actually find the guy's video. Of him describing what happened.
I've seen that video. Actually, he was on stage, and he has his hand. He's like missing part of his hand.
Parts of fingers.
And it's like melted off and shit.
Let's throw that out there. If you are a whistleblower about, alien conspiracies,
please call us.
Please call us. Or get in hold of us, and we'll definitely talk about it.
Yeah.
If you would like to come out as a whistleblower on our show, then we would love that.
Love that.
Yes. But, the guy's interview, he was missing fingers. I mean, he legitimately lost his fingers somehow.
Right.
Whether it was that through or a laser beam or whatever. But, I mean, he's missing fingers either way. So,
well, if he was dying, he wasn't going for celebrityism, apparently. Right. So why the fuck bring it up? I mean, honestly.
Legacy, leaving behind the legacy. I don't know. Who knows what people do anything for?
But that comes into the whole, like, the time traveler that was posting shit on billboards. I can't remember the guy's name. I got to look it up. But he was posting shit about the year 99 and 2012 and this and that. Yeah. And some of the stuff happened. Most of it did not. He had pictures supposedly of the device that was bending time and shit like that. But a lot of people have picked apart the pictures because it's showing like this laser beam that's supposedly bending time and everything. But yet the windows behind that are in the same shot and the same frame of this device are perfectly still and, all squared up when... If it was part of that, everything would be kind of bending together too. So,
and then it's like some of the paranormal videos you watch where, a haunting is happening or poltergeist activity. Everything in the room is thrown around but the camera.
Yeah. Right.
The ghost center is like, fuck that chair, screw this. And,
right.
And don't mess with the camera. That looks
expensive.
Don't
mess the camera,
And see, that's why I like that we're actually in a movie studio right now because things like that, people do stage these things. And
absolutely.
Even if there's video footage, you can't really guarantee that it's real.
Because
I can fake it.
Unless. Yeah.
And and speaking of video footage, real quick, after today's show, you can view our shows online at YouTube.
Right.
Just put in DeadX Radio.
Yeah, after tonight.
Yep, DeadX Radio. You can go there and you can actually watch replays of our shows.
Absolutely.
And with Alexander Holzer, this one, so on and so forth. Yep. So make sure you tune into that and check it out.
Absolutely.
Very good point. Thank you for pointing that out, Chance, because
you're welcome.
I was wondering about that because I would love to watch this show because I can't catch it live.
Well, so, there are those.
I'm busy during those hours.
Those moments where I've gotten messages, during this show that they were like, hey, I missed this segment earlier with Michael Paré because I was doing this or that.
Exactly.
You can go to YouTube and watch our video and actually you can listen to the whole show and watch us live on
it. So. Exactly. And hitting about the faking of videos and evidence and stuff like that. Yes, you can. So when you go into a house, it really is based off of what you feel, what the person with you feels, what you experience. Personal experiences come into play for me more than anything, more than an EMF detector, more than a piece of evidence.
Becoming a tool too, apparently.
I'm not trying to become a tool, but I'm just saying that like your own body and your own personal experiences add more validity to me than any piece of equipment because you know what? Like we all know, I could take my cell phone into the house and it takes a text, it's on silent, and it throws the EMF detector off. Okay. So whatever. Speaking on that note, as paranormal investigators, if you have a problem, please contact us.
Yes.
We will come investigate, and if we can't fix your problem, we will put you in contact with the people who can.
Actually, I got something to say. Chance, Bill Bean does what?
What do you mean he does
House of the Dead?
What does he do? I mean, what?
House of the Dead, right?
Yeah, he does House of the Dead. He's done,
Too
many things to
list
right
now. But that's fine. The reason I'm saying that is, I think next week, maybe we should do the demonstration of how a text or something of the EMF detector.
Yeah.
Next week on DedX Radio.
Sure, we can. Actually, I like that idea. Do a live demonstration, let people see that.
Let's see it. So they can see that, you know, not everything is a damn ghost.
That we're not bullshitting.
I mean, right,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. We're not bullshitting.
We're not just saying things to make it up, you know what I mean? Yeah,
yes, because here at DedX Radio, we will put these things to the test. And if someone's going to say, oh, you know, this is 100%, we're going to be like, okay, we'll prove it. And we're going to figure out a way to prove it. We're like Mythbusters, but we're idiots.
You know, you really touch base and
that you're an
a
idiot.
Lot of truth. Yeah, and let's be realistic. I mean, when it comes down to investigations, yes, there is a certain amount of, you know, intelligence and study and research and everything else, but a lot of it is trial by error.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
realistically, it's just like
trial by error.
It's just like
trial and error.
Trial and error. Thank you. But what I'm saying is,
I like the by error better.
Well, a lot of people don't realize that being an investigator, it really is. It's a whole lot of just saying, okay, let's see if one and one actually make two.
Right, and that didn't work, so let's come back with something else and see if that works.
Yep, absolutely.
Yep.
And you know what? And you were talking about feelings earlier. I mean, feelings.
Nothing more than
I hate you all.
I know. We hate you too.
Good. But I don't want to like, because I don't think you clarified too much on the other side of that, because I don't trust people's feelings either. Because I think people's feelings.
Well, fuck you too.
Bullshit.
I got two words for you. Fuck you.
Fuck you. Yeah, but because...
And on that note...
here's the reality. Our brains...
Here's the reality.
When you understand the science behind the way our brains work, our brains will send certain signals that make us feel, quote-unquote, certain things based on the thoughts that are going through our head. So, case in point, we could be here and I could tell you something, and based on something you think, you will get chills.
Yeah, I won't.
You will get hairs.
Yeah.
Stand on end.
Hairs.
I won't believe him.
Good point.
I know. We should be doing the show out there where it's cold.
I know, right?
Thanks for stucking us in a closet.
On that note, hey, but on that note, seriously, I think we're out of time.
No, we have 1 minute left.
We have 1 minute left.
I wasn't done talking.
Well, you go on for days.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, that's the great thing about us owning the program. We can go as long as we want.
Yeah, fuck you. I mean, you know, we're going 5 more minutes now, bitch. All because of you.
Well, I'll fucking walk away. I don't give a fuck.
It's time for me to smoke. I don't know what the hell you guys are going to do.
All right, so I want to say one last word.